You know you oughta pump the brakes. I can't tell you why. Don't you let it go. Well, I'm the line, and if I'm hurry, I'ma let you know you're somewhere in between my lanes. Hey, you know there ain't another girl like her in the city. Yeah, yeah, you know she looks so good, but she ain't so pretty. Can't believe I rode so long.
Make it count.
I must practice tolerance.
Next, GSL Season 3. Reversal. 2019, Mountain Dew, GSL Season 3, Code S. Reversal.
What's up, everybody? I'm back. I missed you. Welcome to the GSL. Dad's home. Thanks for everybody who subbed in for me. It's really appreciated. Had an excellent family trip, but I did miss casting with you, Artosis.
That's good. You should have.
I was getting a little bit jealous about these sidecasters you have.
Felt it weird that I wasn't invited on the family trip, to be honest.
Yeah.
You care to explain? Or
I don't know. It was a little bit weird. You're right.
Just because Dana has the same last name as you, he's your brother?
Yeah. No, it was a great family trip. And, again, thank you to everybody who subbed in. They all did a great job. Now we go on to Group D. As you can see, Rogue Special, Dark, Ragnarok Stats, and Cure have already advanced.
Yeah, it's been a very exciting and entertaining Code S thus far. The power, like the, how do you put this? The balance of power continues to sway around.
Yeah.
You know, obviously we haven't seen too many Protosses advance as of yet. I'm sure their time is coming.
Right.
But I don't know, this season, not feeling at all like last season so far. By this time last season, how many upsets do we have? Like 15 upsets?
We had a lot. It was pretty
after
surprising.
Three groups?
Yeah. It was pretty insane. 2019 already, well, we're pretty deep into 2019 now, but insanely different from the way it was last year in 2018.
Sure.
So here's the group we have today.
Yeah, it's a very exciting group. So we do have a couple Protoss players here. You know, we'll see who can get out from that. Obviously, Sue is always in very good shape. But kind of the person that most people's eyes should be on tonight is Dream.
Yeah.
This guy was considered insanely talented back when he played. And didn't do anything super big, but everyone was talking about how strong he was. Then he's done his military service. He's back. People are saying he is the strongest out of the returning pros.
And I think for our two Protoss players, question marks by both of their names here. How are they going to perform this season? These are both players who have been insanely dominant, been in the forefront of how we learn, you know, how malleable Protoss can actually be. But they have not performed as well as I think they would have wanted to. And both these guys have had times where we really thought they would actually come out and completely murder and dominate. And I think in this period of time, they have not been, I guess we could say they've been underperforming a little bit to what a lot of people expected.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that sentiment. But first off, we do have our ZVT for the night. Sue. I mean, it's Sue. What can we say? He won Katowice already this year.
Right.
He's in good shape. He's been playing pretty well overall. But yeah, I mean, I think overall he's probably the biggest favorite to get out of the group.
He was the only player that got second place so many times that we sort of said he actually is the best in the world because it's that hard to even get to that many finals.
It's something like that. Like he didn't have that finishing power, but...
Yeah, but the fact that he was beating everybody to get there over and over, and it wasn't like he had any kind of one Achilles heel as far as an opponent goes. Instead, it was really more about... I think him trying to overcome the finals atmosphere, which of course he has now finally done this year.
Yeah, very, very important. And of course, Dream over here. Again, people have always spoken highly of his skill. We're going to see what he has here tonight.
And I think it's great that he's done with his military service.
Yeah.
When you get that out of the way as a pro, and we could talk a little bit more about this in the cast, but once you have that out of the way, if you want to go back into being a professional gamer, you have all the time in your life to train, and there's not going to be any other interruptions.
You know, the military is the sword of Damocles over all these other pros, whereas Dream has this kind of unlimited potential in StarCraft II, where it's like, well, you can just let loose, and, you know, there's no time limit. As long as you can make it work, you can make it work.
Okay, game one is up. We're going to Cyber Forest. Sue versus Dream starts now. Oh my God, we're almost to 4,000.
Chivo, Sue.
Here's a question for you. Are we going to get through by the end of the year?
Yeah.
So you're saying we have 46 more matches?
Mm-hmm. Don't make me do math on TV.
See,
I hate
five.
This.
Yeah, you're right. We're going to make it.
Oh, I should have just stayed confident.
Brave Stars Gaming, Dream.
Yeah, look at this. Little bit of aggression from Sue here. Getting his gas in his pool before any hatcheries.
Yeah. This might be because of the Dream was gone for a while. Now he's back. So why not open up with something really aggressive, test out how he's playing.
Sure.
Maybe try to do something to him before he really gets into his comfort zone. You know, whenever you're in a tournament match, eventually, you know, the wiggles, the anxiety will go away. Mm-hmm. But it can take a little bit of time, so this is cool to see.
Yeah, interested to see what he's going to end up doing with
this. On the honeymoon!
Whoa!
Congratulations! That's so cool.
Yeah, you and I have a similar story.
Yeah.
We met playing StarCraft.
We did.
Yeah. And here we are.
And here we are.
On an 11-year honeymoon so far.
That's right. We're still in our honeymoon phase after all this time. So the SCB.
We're one of those. Those couples.
Well, we had one of those open relationships where I let you cast with four other guys while I was out of town for a week. So it was. Yeah.
And a girl.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's fine. Swinger casters, whatever. Now, we've got the SCB coming in here. This is a pretty quick scout. Back at home, the Terran is making the CC on the low ground.
Yeah, you know, Sue, just a few lings out there. He's kind of scouting all over the place. It almost seems like he's utilizing this early pool and speed and whatnot for safety purposes, right? He's just kind of scouting around. Maybe he thought he was going to be proxy barracks or something like that. Maybe that's something he's seen Dream doing a lot on the ladder.
Yeah.
You never know.
Yeah, this seems to be...
Oh, look at that.
Oh, wow, look.
You see that three rounds?
Yeah, right there in the very, very bottom.
Yeah, he's being a bit sneaky, isn't he?
Clearly, that's not the most efficient place to put it, so obviously he's trying to hide that.
Yeah.
We have any, there's no overlords down there.
No.
So that is just not going to get scouted at all.
Yeah, you'd have to get a Ling kind of luckily up the ramp to be able to see that one, which, I mean, it's a possibility since the speed will be done so quickly, but this is kind of, it's just a little bit of a cheeky play here from Dream. And to be honest, what he's playing against, theoretically, this should be pretty good against it, right? Because if you skip out on your hatchery to get the early speed and the early pull, and you don't do anything with it, then you're kind of catching up on economy, right? So, like, if you're going to try to hit a more sharp timing as the Terran player here, you're kind of catching them with a build order that doesn't want to deal with this. They want that, like, longer period of no harassment coming in the mid-game.
A bigger window of time where they're a little bit more safe.
So, you know, theoretically looking at these builds, I like Dream's position, even though it's, like, not a build that you really ever see.
Yeah, I guess we'll also have to see how he actually executes the attack as well.
Yeah.
Because one thing about Sue is whatever he's doing, he's usually doing it pretty much almost perfectly.
Yeah, that's
true. So a lot of times people come in to games against Sue with strategies that I guess on paper should work, but the opponent doesn't quite pull the right moves off.
Mm-hmm. Well, just a little bit of poking up at the front here. You notice where that third base was taken?
Yeah.
That is definitely a very pushable location if
Absolutely.
You break those rocks down. Especially if you get siege tanks with this factory that he's just thrown a tech lab onto.
And it appears that this is just not going to be scouted or seen until the build itself activates. And, you know, hold on, we got one Link coming down here, but that's not going to get in there. He's got Hellions over there at the entrance. He's very intelligently put the Marines, he's parked them in the main. This is a great way to pull the Marines there so that even if they get up to the front, you still. Everything looks like it should be a more standard build, when in fact it's not.
And he's even moved a decent amount down to the front, too. So, like, he's doing everything he really can to hide exactly what this is. Now, there's a lot of links being made by Sue right now. It seems like he's going to get aggressive. And I feel like he thinks he's probably against something like a three command center play.
So this is going to be a little bit of an odd exchange here because... Yeah, but if he thinks it's three command center play, then he's obviously expected to come in here and do damage, when in fact there's going to be a big army, which is intended to push here.
Yeah, he's selling it too. Dream should be way ahead after this.
Yeah.
He should be way ahead.
Certainly not a good position to be in. Now, the Hellions are saved. Very nicely done by the medevac. And the Roaches were just obliterated. And now, after Sue has really not done much of anything to the Terran, I mean, he killed the depot. But he lost quite a bit. He's going to go back home. And so from here, I think we're probably going to see this rush come out. Now, the key thing about this rush that would throw the Zerg off is the heavy amount of Marines in a push like that. There's a little bit less medevacs. So in theory, if the Zerg could win the fight, there would not be enough medevacs to pick everything up and run away. Mm-hmm. But of course, the idea for the Terran is that this is actually just going to be enough. You're not planning on trying to run away.
Yeah. I feel like he should definitely think about removing those rocks because... This, like, Sue's whole hold right now is hinged on that little area.
Yeah, I feel like Dream is wavering a little bit here. I think he needs to, stim and run through.
Yeah, that's a fine way to do it as well. Just as long as you get through there without really taking the damage. Now, counterattack from Sue.
Yeah, the Lings can actually eat up all the Marines that are going to reinforce here, and then it becomes a matter of the Zerg trying to buy enough time to get a big enough army to then come in here and smash this small force that's coming through from the Terran. And so far, I actually have to say, Sue is executing this very, very well, considering he was sort of thrown into this situation and didn't realize what was really going on until his attack failed.
Yeah, it feels like everything Sue has chosen to do so far didn't work out kind of on a blind basis from both sides.
Yeah.
But he's playing a strong game. Look at that.
Great Biles there.
Yeah.
And so the remainder of the army is picked up. It seems like Dream is not going to try to back off, but I do wonder if doubling down is really a good idea here. You know, the number of Ravagers that are going to be out, every tank that comes in here is basically going to get one shot off before it gets biled down.
Feels that way right now.
Yeah.
A big thing to point out here is Dream isn't really preparing for anything else. He never got an engineering bay. He doesn't have any sort of upgrades going. It's just combat shields and stim, and that's it.
Yeah, there's no plan B here. So, I mean, this is essentially the Zerg
unlike most games where you have to try to take out the third base, this is one where you just have to outlast this push and keep expanding, and you're going to win that way quite easily.
All right, so trying to do something up here on the high ground. Sue, though, he's doing a good job of kind of keeping everything pushed back. I feel like Dream is not executing this super well, and like watching this game so far, it just feels like Sue is a better player. You know what I mean?
Right. Okay. Pushing through here from the top. Now, this will be a good way to deny this expansion, but again, a Zerg on three bases on a Terran versus a Terran who's just on two for now is going to be okay. Hold on. The drop comes in. He's going to go back up.
Okay. Drop Grassman, obviously going to be a reasonable idea against Road Ravager.
The spot he's in here, this could be picked off by Queens. And this is this looks like it might be a little victory here. Oh, actually, you know what? I think Terran might be driven away.
It's possible. There is a lot of Road Ravager right there.
Yeah. Now, the tanks are pretty well placed, but the Marine army isn't actually large enough to really do anything. And kind of like we were saying earlier, really, the corrosive biles just obliterate the tank every time. So the tank count is constantly being reset, which is going to make this not just harder for the Terran to push, but also it's going to be much harder for the Terran to defend when Sue finally gets that upper hand and can push out. Mm.
This has been a really a strange and different game that we're watching here, right? This, it feels like, and here's the thing, obviously Dream's been playing for a bit since he's been out of the army, right? People do practice a little bit while they're there as well. Obviously, he's in good shape. He's made it into GSL, all those things, okay? So I want to say that ahead of time. But watching this, it feels like we have a player from the past playing.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways. The strategy is a little bit anachronistic. It's like, I feel like the execution overall is not quite there, right?
Yeah. It does look like we had a player, we put him in a time travel machine and sent him into the future, and here he is trying to play in a different meta. It just did not. I was curious how it was going to pan out because it's not a typical strategy that we saw here from Dream. But frankly, Sue just handled it so easily that, maybe if someone else was doing this, it would go a little bit better. But it seemed like a pretty easy deflection for Sue, right?
Yeah. So far, really. He everything he did in the beginning didn't really do much. And then he just still kind of held on.
unless there's a very specific part of this timing, like you get in there just fast enough that you kind of, the game spirals out of control for the Zerg. Remember that there was that little valley where the biles are being shot into over and over and over again as well.
Yeah, it slows him down
and he was sort of out there waiting. I think he really could have actually stibbed and just ran through, but he didn't. He was sort of almost intimidated.
The Lings catching the reinforcements, helping out with the flank and things like that. Those are important things that Sue has done this game.
Okay.
Dream, though, I mean, he's not out of it. You know, I almost feel like we're talking like the game is over. And
it was a weak push, though.
Yeah. Sue is in a good spot, right? He's ahead on upgrades and all that. But, you know, you look at this monster spite he has, it's almost all Road Ravager. So if you can hold on against this long enough, it doesn't scale as well as a lot of things Terran is.
But I think he's almost supply dumping here in this attack as well. It's a big, scary army, but he can then remake different units. Actually, excuse me, he's going to make 36, four more Lings. And more Road Ravager. And I guess he just wants to crash this into the third base over and over again until eventually the Terran is smothered. And frankly, even though there's a counterattack push here, I think these hatches are expendable. I don't know that this big army from Sue can actually be stopped. That's just outside the natural here. What is it, one tank? Somehow these biles are just not quite connecting with it.
Yeah. But there's some cool moves going on. Like, look, the counterattack killed a hatchery there. I almost wish that he had gone up to that 12 o'clock base and killed that instead of trying to push. But he's got a couple liberators set up. He's, you know, Dream is making some cool moves. It's not like we have hive tech for Sue, right? That's kind of your finishing move. If you can't bludgeon him, you got to go hive.
I feel as though Dream's small army that has done quite a bit of damage is just eventually going to be mopped up, and from there the Zerg should just have a big enough army. It's going to be a straightforward game. See, right over here, he's going to attack into that. That'll be forced to lift. I'm assuming the Terran is probably getting close to mining out at the natural, right?
Should be, yeah.
Especially with all the remaining mules are now going to be landing there until that third gets up and running.
Yeah, his income definitely is going to start falling apart here. Needs to have that third base active, and he does have it relanded and everything.
And frankly, I don't even think Sue needs to try to tech out of what he's doing. I think you just stay with what you have and just keep
kind of smothering this third.
It makes me a little bit nervous because, like, that's one of the great ways to throw. How many Zergs over the last, how long has StarCraft 2 been out now? Like 9 years?
8.5, I think.
Yeah, so how many Zergs have we seen throw games where they just keep throwing roaches at their opponent?
That it's is like, true. Well, I like the transition. I like the Banelings part of this, though.
Yeah, that's nice.
Because the Banelings are going to allow him to just have enough explosive damage that there's not going to be much time to even have a real fight.
He might roll through. It might just all come down to siege tank placement, whether or not he can eliminate those before they get their value in. But look, the 2-2 just finished. So now we're even on upgrades, right? The Dream's army, again, it scales better than what Sue is doing for sure.
Right.
You know, he's floating out some additional command centers here, so maybe he can get a fourth base up and running. That would be huge for him.
That's not the CC from the main, is it? That's actually a new fourth CC, right?
Yeah, that's a new CC. Well, a semi-used CC. It is in the yellow. So
yeah.
It's not brand new.
Pawn shop CC.
Yeah.
I like the idea, though, of what Dream's trying to do here. I mean, considering this is a pretty bad position for him, I think he's doing the very best he can, given the circumstances that he's in right now. Oh, my God, run! Okay.
Oh, so I guess you're a Terran fan.
It's like, are we going to see all the medevacs and the ground army die to Biles? It's not every day in GSL we get to actually have that. It's funny how Biles are more of a zoning thing than anything else, unless you're doing stuff like fighting tanks and liberators.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is obviously not going to happen for the Terran. He's going to have to float that back.
Yeah, he's having a hard time just overall this maxed out army, right? 140 army supply. It's pretty darn strong. He's got the speed upgrades for everything, 2-2. I mean, you can't fight that too easily. But look, 140 against 115. If Dream's army is set up correctly, he can do reasonably well against this, especially as his supply goes up. More tanks we have in here, the harder it gets, especially if they're split up a little bit.
Well, let's see how this next attack goes, because if Terran holds off this attack, then Terran has kind of done it and survived, I think, a big rocky part of this game here.
Yeah. He's actually getting close to the point where this game can turn around.
It's funny, because even if the build didn't work out, you can see mechanically and tactically, Dream is pretty sound as a player. You know, even if he's coming out with something that maybe isn't worth trying in a tournament, he still held his own and was harassing well enough that he drug the game out.
I'm kind of fascinated by his play this game.
Yeah, me too.
Definitely we're going to have to unpack it a bit more after the game, but if he ends up pulling a victory out here, yeah, that's going to be even more interesting. Oh, my God.
Wow. All right.
Have you seen that before, Dream?
Yeah, that's not supposed to happen.
Yeah. I mean, everyone launches those Biles, but
yeah.
You
might as well.
To hit.
Yeah.
You're just kind of taxing your opponent a little bit.
Okay, we have a lot more Banelings being made here. And we're going to try to have an attack in here. I said a lot. It's like four Banelings. But he's making some more Banelings here.
Whoa, Tasis.
And let's see if Sue actually tries to come in and attack.
Well, 3-3 is on the way here for Dream. So his army is going to get a bit better. Now, here comes Sue rolling up this ramp right now. And actually attacking another location as well. That attack, absolutely not going to do it. He gets held everywhere.
Wow, he was deflected on both fronts. There was enough firepower that the Banelings were not actually able to connect in with the army. You know, one of the ideas when you're hitting two locations like that is there's no way for a Terran player physically to kite on two different screens.
Yeah.
So you have to have really good immediate prioritizing and say, okay, this is the fight that matters more, and then run back. But in this case, the Banes never connected, and so basically, it was just Sue losing on both sides there.
Yeah, now he's fighting against 3-3 Marine Marauder Siege Tank.
Yeah, just better late-game composition here as well.
Yeah.
Oh, I love this. If this tank can get over here.
He's got to be careful about those Biles coming down. But look at this. He's trying to fight right now. A huge amount of Lynx and Banes come in from the side. I think that's going to give Sue enough to push this back.
Yeah, just such a big army here. The kiting continues on. In fact, Sue going to try to run around here and cut this off at the pass.
Yeah, you're not going to be able to lift quite well. He gets most of it in, I guess, actually. Yeah, that's a lot more medics than I thought. But it does run back to his Liberators, to his Rally Point.
Do you just keep going for it here? Do you try to run all the way into one of these bases with the rest of your Lynx and Banes?
I think as Sue, you got to wait for your higher-tech units. You've already proven a few times that you can't quite finish him with this comp. So let's get into those other units to try to do so. All right, comes in with this big attack, throws down a huge amount of Biles. Does get, I mean, he gets rid of some of the valuable units. hitting some medevacs here and there, liberators, some siege tanks. This 3-3 is going to be finishing up pretty quickly here. Kitenus plating and Ultra's coming out as well.
This has actually been such a good game between these two.
This is such an interesting game as well. It's not just kind of like action-packed, but
yeah.
Strategically what's being used with that three racks play that was kind of early, the fact that he skipped his E-bays for a long time and for a long time Sue's ahead on upgrades. Very interesting game in a lot of ways.
Okay, again, Sue is coming here trying to pummel the army. The more Bailing's coming down, Marauder's splitting up. And it just seems like there's so much over here. Are we at the breaking point?
Maybe.
You know, if you can get it down to just Marauders versus Roach Ravager, then the Roach Ravager eventually has to turn around, and that's what's happening right now.
I tell you, that parasitic bomb was pretty nasty. You see his medevac count has dropped sharply, a lot of them very badly injured. Looks like Drilling Claw is on the way, a bunch of Ultras being made as well, and while the 3-3 Marauder siege tanks with plus two, like, you can kind of fight the Ultras, I feel like, you know, when you start seeing enough Ultras, you really do want to get into Ghosts.
Yeah, we need to get to that final tech here.
Not sure he's going to be able to, though. It's kind of a turning into a scrappy game as well.
Yeah, the thing is, we're basically seeing Dream just barely hang on over and over and over again, but the problem is Ultras take so long to kill. You eventually see the army get kited into the corner where they can't go any further, and there's still damage being distributed.
Yeah, look at that big bad boy in the fourth base.
Run! Oh, got him. Zapped him.
Yeah. The spy's getting kind of low, though, on both sides, right? And when we get down to these very scrappy ones, you can really micro heavily with your Terran units.
Terran is pretty much also at the limit of how much of the map you can reach out and mine from. You know, the idea of Terran taking either the bottom left or the base close to the upper right, that's going to be pretty hard to hold, right? So Terran needs to kind of hang on to this and try to maybe even go for an exhaust for the Zerg. All right, another attack in here. Dream is constantly having to relocate and then land this base and try to suck up as many minerals before the maxed out Zerg army comes in here with Lings and Ultras and hits that again and again and again.
It's funny, he actually only has one Ultra left and he's not buying any more right now.
Yeah, he switched like, out of that.
Yeah, Sue does not have a big bank, and Ultras are kind of a unit that you need a bunch of other units with, right?
Yeah.
So if we're getting to lower supplies, I don't mind the fact that he's kind of getting away from that a little bit, you know?
Okay. Again, he's hitting over here in the upper right. And I have to say, I like that Dream's doing quite a bit with not very much here as far as harass, because if he was harassing with big drops, then he would be losing these bases at the bottom. But instead, Sue is attacking it, for instance, at that 6 o'clock base, hitting hard, but the SCVs are pulled out. Eventually, the key units like the Ultras are killed off, and then he gets to land again and reclaim it.
Right now, you know, Dream has a lot of injured medevacs here. The Spire I'm interested in, like, are we going to see just greater Spire coming up? Does he want a few Corruptors mixed into this to chase down medevacs with? That definitely can be useful with this composition as well.
Yeah, it could be. I think it might be the Corruptor play, actually, but we'll find out in a second.
I would like the Corruptor play here. I think it'd be really, really smart.
Okay, great harpooning there, pulling those Liberators forward. There's just not very much to defend here, and once again, the CC is forced to lift up. The Ravager's biling down those Liberators. Does Zerg actually have enough to hit that other base? Oh, you know what? I hadn't even noticed how low on minerals that base was. That third is almost mined out.
Yeah, well, luckily he has that other high ground base as well.
Right.
So Dream still has some income, at least. Obviously, Sue with a much bigger one, a lot of bases out there right now. But it's such an action-packed game, he's not even able to quite max out.
Once again, chased away. It's kind of insane to watch Dream just hang on for this long. We're getting to 20 minutes, a little bit over 20 minutes.
Well, I think a big part of this is the unit composition that Sue's been playing with this entire game, right? He tried to kind of end the game early on, didn't quite work, got him a lead. But then he almost got shoehorned into doing just Roach Ravager for so long. And Dream showing he knows how to defend against this. He knows how to keep himself alive and give himself a shot.
Okay, Bane's coming forward again here. Man, these medevacs are so low on HP. And once again, Terran holds. It's always Ravagers alone running away after each of these fights.
And the couple of... God, why did my brain just die?
No, you're fine.
Anyways, the parasitic bombs, that is what I'm trying to say here. The parasitic bombs that we saw from those Vipers.
Yeah.
Like, he just keeps gaining value because there's no real anti-air here whatsoever. which again leads me to believe that it would be pretty cool to see just a few corruptors put in, because he'd clean out the medevacs, and the medevacs are one of the real long-term units here keeping him in.
Again, another attack over here. The Liberator shot down. I don't think it was a wise decision for Terran to try to move out there. I think really Dream miscalculated how much supply his opponent had, and so GG. Sue takes game number one, but that was an epic.
That was a really cool game right there. I'm surprised that Dream made such a nice game out of it, but to be honest, you know, he held on against this composition that it gets this huge amount of supply, it can do these strong attacks to you, but the actual finishing move with Roach Ravager can be very tough, and Sue was unable to do that, which almost let Dream right back into it. Very interesting game, and I'm not at all sure what to expect after watching that.
You know, if I'm Dream, I'm feeling pretty good about that game.
Yeah?
I mean, he was really holding his own. He was in a bad spot for pretty much all of the game, but was actually hanging on and surviving. I guess the big question is, what kind of strategy is Dream going to implore here? We're going to GSL Cobalt for game four.
Oh, cool. Oh, I'm... This should be very interesting. You know, a four-player map. What are the spawns going to look like? Are they going to be cross spawns or something like that? I feel like that would really play into Sue's hand, especially the style Dream just showed us.
Game two is loaded up. Sue vs. Dream continues on.
Chivo, Sue. Brave Stars Gaming, Dream.
So, what shall we be seeing here? I'm very excited about Dream, actually. I like want to see more of his games right now.
Yeah.
And I guess I do get to see more of his games tonight, at least three more. But hopefully more than that. And, yeah, it's...
From Finland, welcome. Thank you for coming down.
Hey, do you know Sarah? But, yeah, so this is kind of almost a tough group right now to, you know, if I put on my fan hat and try to decide who to cheer for, it's like, well, Sue, you always want Sue getting deep. Always.
Yeah.
I'm a Zest boy, okay?
I know you are.
I'm one of the loyal people that realizes that Zest always has been, always will be one of the world's greatest Protoss players.
Yeah.
Okay?
You are a Zest fanboy.
No. Not a fanboy, just someone who realizes the truth about Zest.
Okay, my bad. Okay? Yeah.
And I know that some people don't realize that truth, which is always funny. But anyways, Dream is... I don't know. It's just interesting to see these guys coming back.
Oh, wow.
Runner
of brothers. Look at that.
That's Sue.
Why is Sue bald?
I love it. Yeah. It was a perfect picture of him.
Okay.
Yeah. All the returning players are just interesting ones for me. And seeing which ones are in what type of shape, right? We've seen so many of them coming back recently. And I actually really like when we get to hear the interviews that everyone gave as well that we'll be seeing on a later commercial break. And seeing what they think. Like, for instance, While You're Gone, Bomber played, right? And he's like, yeah, I mean, I'm here in the GSL, but I don't think I'm going to really show anything here. It's going to be next year that you're going to see my power, you know?
Yeah.
Like, see it return finally. I just wonder what kind of a rating Dream gives to himself if everyone else is saying he's the best of the return players.
What is your whole take on when we have these players that are interviewed in the GSL and they Jury will ask them to rate themselves. They'll be like, oh, I give myself like a D, like the person that gets out first.
Oh, yeah.
What is that?
It's become almost a little bit of a meme. And the thing is, I think that here's the like, a lot of times it's Terran players doing this first off. Okay, Maru is the big one where he's like, he wins a group 4-0. Like, how do you think he plays like 40%?
I know, what is that?
And here's the thing, though. I think he believes it.
I know, that's what's weird about it, though. He'll, like, win one of the craziest base trades ever and be like, yeah, I'd give myself like,
a C-. I messed up a bunch of times there. A bunch of times.
I can't believe I've even got myself into a base trade situation. Yeah.
Well, I think that there's this funny thing that goes on in the pro gamer mind where you're always striving towards perfection, which is the same reason why whenever you see like pro gamers cast games, a lot of times they'll say that someone's dead and then the other person's
like one juggling.
Everything is based off the idea of perfect play that no one ever does ever.
Yeah.
Because StarCraft is a game of making fewer mistakes of your opponent many times.
Yeah. It's a game of juggling.
So, yeah. The thing is, like, maybe you played 40% compared to a game that would have looked perfect, but it's like, you know what? You can't always play perfect games because your opponent's going to mess you up too. Like, this is why the game's good, okay?
Yeah.
If everyone played perfect, we'd figure out what race is best and it would be over.
Right.
Like, no one would want to watch it.
So, this
OBC.
Time around. Yep.
Finally looking at the game.
Yeah. Coming back. It was a good conversation. We came back. I'm like, okay, so what is actually happening here?
Like a fusion core. Oh
yes. Yeah.
So you're gonna see the
in reality, it would make sense if this game was based at all in reality that you would want a battlecruiser against an alien race. You know, this is obviously the best unit. Does it bother you that the battlecruiser costs, you know, the supply that it does when, in fact, if you look at it, it's like, well, in the single player, there's more than that supply in the ship itself, so.
Well, you're the one assigning supplies to those people in there, right?
That's true.
A marauder and a marine cost the different supplies, but they have the same amount of people in them.
Yeah, the marauder just needs to eat more.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe
that he burns more calories running around in that big suit.
Yeah. Should stim him less often.
Yeah.
One supply marauders without stim. Would you make those? I think so. Yeah, right? Imagine
how
many marauders you could get.
That'd be fine. Yeah.
You could get twice as many, theoretically, in like a Big Max game. If you have a huge bank.
It'd be like when it was, what was it, one supply of roaches right when the game came out, but worse.
Oh, that was amazing.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. You've never seen so many roaches as back then. Okay, here
okay,
comes
here
the first BC.
Teleport! Zap, 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 zap!
Yeah. So the queen's gonna come up really well placed. Queen's over.
Oh
my
god! So good! With the Hellions coming in!
Amazing. These Hellions are badasses to time it out like this.
Yeah, this is great. But he's sort of driven the battlecruiser away now. The battlecruiser normally kind of roams into the main and tries to kill drones there, but instead.
Well, he was pretty ready for it.
Yeah.
Now, there is a spire on the way. We'll see if it's going to be Corruptor or Muta. I think it's probably going to be Corruptor. And it is a mech transition here.
Great.
For Dream. Also, as soon as you see him get Yamato, generally you can look at that and say, okay, they're going to be making BCs pretty much nonstop.
Yeah.
Which, I like that style so much more. Making one BC, it's like, oh, you got a fusion core to make one BC? Get out of here.
It's a lot of tech waste.
You
want to
play a game like that?
Utilizing it.
Yeah, it is.
Well, also, I mean, just the ability to teleport. And the battlecruiser is so beefy that, you know, it can stay there and you're basically guaranteed to kill and do a lot of destruction.
Yeah.
And again, if you don't kill the battlecruiser, the Terran has basically lost nothing.
Yeah, he's not going to lose anything. It's going to be like repair money, right?
Yeah.
You're careful with it for a little bit. You know basically how far you can stretch and then you jump out.
And this really taxes the Zerg incredibly. I mean, he has to run around. Uh-oh. That's the BC's brother.
Yeah.
The double dragon BC play.
Look at that. I mean, really reasonable damage so far here.
Yeah.
This BC is doing fantastically. Look at that, all these queens coming down here.
Oh, these Hellions are suddenly going to get a lot of value just being here.
Get the bandling.
Sue just kind of sending some units across the map right now. Looks like the other one probably jumped home. This one's still trying to get some harassment, but this one jumped in, so he's got to be a little bit more careful with it. It does not have a jump home ready.
That's right. There was like a WWE play where he tagged the other BC in.
Yeah, I think he's going to lose this one.
Oh, get out, get out, get out, get out. No. Yeah, he's done. He's done.
Wow, he got that last piece, that last queen.
Now
but still, I mean, these have done fantastically.
Yeah, and there's about to be another one that's going to come out.
Yeah. Bunch of corruptors coming out, though. These will help. If you jump any in, you're going to lose them now.
Yeah.
That's what that says. But you don't have to. Like, you can keep them at home.
Yeah, just keep them with your army.
Yeah. Nothing feels more efficient, by the way, than a BC Yamato-ing a corruptor that was made only to stop a BC.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Just like, wow. If corruptors could not shoot buildings now, you know, that would just be the saddest thing you could ever see.
Yeah, that was a necessary feature for them to have to give them some versatility.
Yeah, they were so silly before that.
Yeah.
And you don't even see it that often, but at least there feels like potential.
Yeah.
And that's important. You've got to give the people hope.
So, we've got the two BCs out here now, covering this in between the natural and the third base. And we're continuing to see tanks come out. Now, Ravagers are being made. I don't know what the tank count is at exactly. Okay, it's at two.
So there should be enough Ravagers, depending on the positioning, for him to just come in there and hit that.
See? Doesn't that feel good?
Yeah.
Okay, he's going to hit this base, and I mean, it's going to be a little bit tough to get in here and stop this from happening. Oh, nice file. Yeah, really nice.
Oh, nice teleport away. I think that he's just going to break in here, right? There's enough Ravagers. There's no tanks,
well,
correct?
He's dealing some damage, sure, but I don't think, that there's really much potential to kill. With tanks on the high ground, the BCs are still here. Eventually, the Corruptors are not going to kill everything. Cyclone's helping out a little bit as well. So, I mean, he does some damage with it. He does all right. He's got a lot of supply, sure, but...
Getting a few more tanks out, it looks like Dream's going to try to, once again, claim this area. Now, keep in mind that Sue is almost maxed out. Mm-hmm. And in a position like this, once you're maxed out, you're going to take everything you have and throw it at that third base and try to clobber the Terran once more.
Yeah, is he going to be able to clobber him here? Let's see. I mean, he's pulling him back right now into some of these sea chinks on high ground. So,
oh, my God. These vials are doing so much damage on the BCs and what's underneath.
Oh, my God.
You know, Dream, I got to say, after these two games, he is having a little bit of a hard time not just eating damage from vials.
Oh, my God. There's only one Corruptor left, and it's very, very red.
One of those tanks didn't even have a death animation. It just disappeared.
Felt like it should have.
Yeah, it, like, evaporated. Okay.
Nice finish there by Sue.
Excellent play by Sue.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, Dream's looking good. And this might be just the beginning of more great Dream games in GSLs. And there's that smile. He's always got that smile.
Sue did well, but I am overall reasonably impressed with Dream. I think he's playing pretty well. You know, you got to do better than pretty well, though, to get out of a group like this. Got a bunch of champions here.
Yeah. Okay, guys, we're going to go to a short break. When we come back, a PvP Zest versus Hero at the GSL Codex.
We'll be right back. Are you prepared to go all the way with this, Alexei?
Yes, I am prepared to go all the way.
What's up? We're back. Zest vs. Hero is about to start up. I'm really looking forward to this match specifically. I think these guys both have very interesting approaches to the matchup. Hero is sort of known to be a crazy player to do a lot of very specific timing builds. Zest has in the past occasionally leaned a little bit more on one or two styles in this matchup. Okay. I kind of repeated that in certain days, but let's see what happens.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Sometimes these guys look great. Sometimes they look slightly less in shape. Sometimes one of them doesn't bring his keyboard to the GSL, which is basically the only thing you need to bring.
Which one was that, Artosis?
That would be Hero.
Mm-hmm.
Last
we were talking about
eight.
That. How do you forget a keyboard for a StarCraft tournament? I feel like that's so...
There's very little you need to bring.
To the GSL,
yeah.
You know what I mean? But it
truthfully,
just...
right, if you live in Seoul, it's like, you don't even need a phone or a wallet. You can actually do it. You could jump over the subway stall, just get there, right?
Yeah.
Keyboard and mouse is basically all you need.
Yeah.
You could go with socks on your feet instead of shoes.
Yeah, in Seoul, no one would even stop you for that.
Yeah. Anyways, we're going to see what these guys bring tonight. Who are you thinking?
Well, I'll tell you who I'm rooting for. I've always been a Hero fan.
Yeah, well, Zess is going to beat him, so
yeah,
sorry
well,
about
you're
that,
going
Jesus.
Down. My boy Hero's got this, Artosis.
Listen, just because you're a fan of someone doesn't make it more likely to beat Zess.
If I cheer hard enough, he might play better, and then he'll win.
Could be. Scream and clap at him, Tasis. Let's see.
No, don't lose your probes. They're important.
All right. Kings Cove, Thunderbird, Acropolis. Oh, I really like the map set.
These
definitely can give us some games with three bases, which hasn't been that common in PvP.
That's
lately.
Right. PvP can be pretty tight, pretty explosive. But yeah, we're already getting a very nice map rotation in here. So S versus Hero is about to start up. Sue is waiting for the victor of this in the winner's match. And that game has loaded up now. Let's go.
Fight.
Almost to 1,000.
4,000.
4,000.
Ocean Gaming. Zest.
I love this little icon we have here. The GSL going over the...
Oh, yeah.
We're always stepping it up here to freaking TV.
Triumphant Song Gaming. Hero.
Looks like you found the base. It's like a better comp set.
This is where Hero's face comes up on a little icon at the bottom right and has a speech.
The Zerg have destroyed our lands.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
What was that? Which campaign was it? The one where
where the like Kratos home world was destroyed?
No, the one where the Terrans are on some planet and there's like a this Terran general, and he's like lost his arm.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like, there's something in the dialogue. It's like, oh, I'm so sorry you lost your arm. He's like, I just want to get back out there and kill more Zergs. I thought, I don't think that's what you're supposed to say when you lose your arm. You got to be like, yeah, man, that's like my arm. It's gone.
But don't they go through brainwashing? And that guy's a great soldier, Tasteless. And
yeah,
to be honest,
yeah.
Bionic arm?
Do you know how high my APM would be if I had a bionic arm?
Well, you'd probably let it rust, so probably not that high.
I'd fall asleep, but my hand would be in water. Oh, no. Artos, you tried to make me pee the bed again.
You made Stan
ruin my robot arm.
Oh, my God.
right. Well, down in the bottom, we've already got a pylon hidden here. That's for Zest.
Yeah, both of them look like they're going to hide something down there. That looks like a good place for a Stargate.
Put it right by this giant dog skeleton. And, yeah, the Stargate is going to come in here. So presumably it's going to be an Oracle coming in to blindside and take out as many workers as possible. We need to get a better idea of where Hero's going to take this game. But for now, we do know he has two Adepts that are about to come out.
Yeah. Kind of like that Zest keeps his probe all the way back there. Like, if you want to kill his probe, you got to go all the way into your base to get rid of it.
You know, it's crazy how often this happens in PvP, where there's two players that are hiding something right next to each other.
So often right
it's
now.
It's so crazy.
Yeah. I think that pylons should give bigger vision radius so that this stops happening.
Yeah.
Definitely. Look at how quick that shield battery is.
It's hilarious when they spot each other. It's like that meme where it's the two Spider-Men pointing at each other.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so the Adepts are shading forward. The Stalkers are then forced to come back and preempt that. And it looks like they're not going to be able to shade in, send canceling, but doing a little bit of a control there, keeping the Stalkers back. And now we have the Nexus being made here for Zest. So behind the attack, he's going to try to come in and do some damage on the workers, but it's the same idea over here for Hero.
I think Zest's build here is really, really strong, but
well, it's gonna
start. My god, he canceled the shield battery.
Oh, dude.
It was actually going to be done right now.
Yeah.
And I was about to praise him. I'm like, damn, that's an anti-proxy Oracle shield battery right there.
Well, what's crazy about it, too, is that that is about as close as you can be in that proxy, right?
Yeah.
So it's like he seemed to have almost mistimed the cancellation.
Yes.
You know,
well, he mistimed the starting if it was to catch that, right?
Yeah, which I think it was.
To be frank, like, I mean, if it's going to work, it should be done before the Oracle gets there. You can't, like, have a period of time where it's still finishing, right? So I'm not really sure. It seems like maybe he read it wrong. Like, he was going to let it finish, and then he's like, oh, never mind. But that puts Zest in an even better spot there. He's got his Stalkers at home to defend against Oracle as well. The Nexuses are at similar times.
Okay, well, a little bit of game of cat and mouse here with that. He does kill off both of the Adepts, but we have three probe kills so far. And now we're going to go into Phoenixes here for Hero. Now, notice that Hero's banking up Oracles.
Yeah, he needs that one-shot potential here. See if he
and it looks like he's going to go for it right now. Yeah. And fortunately, there's only two probes over here. So right when he sees this, he's not going to get as many kills off as he would have ideally wanted to get. But he is going to be able to come in here into the main.
Oh, my God. He's actually getting insane damage right now. Look at this.
Oh, my God. He didn't quite have the shot synced up there. So a few missed opportunities, but a dozen probe kills. That is amazing.
Yeah, it really is.
And look at this. There's no probes over here at the natural expansion. Now a Phoenix is going to come and pursue. And two, in fact, excuse me, are going to come and pursue this. And this means that Zest is going to lose his Oracle. Wow.
Yeah, that's kind of painful right there.
Well, there goes Zest's options to have any kind of pin on Hero. Hero can now leave his base with his Stalkers.
Yeah, he can continue to put some pressure on here. He's seen where the Stargate is and everything as well. Hero definitely has the advantage when all is said and done.
Although I do like what Zest is doing. You know, he's taking this bad situation, saying, okay, I can at least warp into depths and try to counterattack there, since Hero in some ways is incentivized to try to come out and get some pressure on over here. But already, Hero reacting perfectly, walls that in and pulls the probes back.
That's kind of crazy.
He's so good. It's so sick.
This game is kind of a really funny one, the way that it's going down, right? They both make these nexuses, but both of them have to retreat because there's so much potential damage everywhere.
We still don't have that natural expansion being mined from right now here for Zest.
Yeah,
I think Hero's going to continue to pull through with a bigger and bigger lead, and I love this. Look, he just spots that over there, takes out the Adepts. Everything that Zest is trying to do is getting shut down.
Yeah. I can't believe that after all this, look how close their worker counts are. 31 to 28. Like, that's pretty similar right there. So surprising after, especially those two Oracles got 12 probe kills.
Yeah.
And then we're just kind of even right now.
Yeah.
So Hero going Forge and Robo. The Robo is already on the other side. Well-placed Observer there to see this coming.
Yeah.
But that's five Phoenixes. They can definitely get some damage done.
Yeah, and anything isolated, they're going to easily kill off.
Yeah.
In fact, I think these Oracles are going to dive into the main. It's going to be just as the shield battery finishes. But the Phoenixes are going to be a great foil here. Look at this. interrupting that, and now the real damage is going to be done.
Oh my god.
As this beautiful rotation comes through and snipes five workers. Now here comes the counterattack from Zest. He's doing a great job attacking these probes, but already Hero has an answer for that too. Zest. How are the supplies still so close?
I know.
This is so weird.
Okay, so Hero has like all the good units, and it feels like everything he has done after the very initial part of the game has been better and more effective. But Zest keeps getting stuff done with almost nothing. It's just like two adepts go in. And then you look at that, oh, five probes dead. Okay. You know, there you go. You kind of equalize it a bit. Obviously, you still got to look at this as a hero. Hero's leading the game, right? He's got this plus one on the way. He still has the Phoenixes. He still has Oracles. Those are all big deals.
Okay, a little recall there to pull those adepts back. You don't want those to get isolated and then chewed up by the Phoenixes. So even though the supplies are even, I feel like Hero's pulling off great play after great play after great play. We have the War Prism coming here now as well. And so that might be the moment where Hero will have the option to push and or harass. Keep in mind that there's basically no air here anymore for Zest. So there's no, you know, Phoenixes are kind of ideal to just chase away a War Prism. So I feel like Hero's going to be able to leverage his position more and more and more as the game goes on.
Yeah, you can really see him doing that as well. He just sacrifices four Oracles and only got two sentries with it.
But even up the supply now.
Yeah, he kills 10 probes there. Look at that, 33 to 31. Is Hero just not into building workers? I think if we look at it,
I think that's actually what's been happening.
Yeah,
here, is that he's the reason why he's able to do so much damage and come out on the map and be so fierce is because he's cut probes often.
It seems that way because Zest is not killing anywhere near as many, right? 29 to 19. Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, that means Hero for sure was cutting probes.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, we should have Hero with like a 20-25 supply lead here for the amount of damage he's done. So even though Zest is taking damage, he's just being patient and remaking workers and then trying to get back on his feet.
Look how funny these armies are right now.
Ooh.
Bop. Okay, are you a member of Handsome?
What? Hanson? Call me Handsome?
Well, I always call you Handsome, but are you a member of Hanson?
Yes.
Your little mbop right there.
Scop, mbop. Get it on down now. Can I tell you something? My brother and me actually used to listen to that a lot. We liked that song when we were kids.
I always thought you guys were cool.
Yeah, we were not. So we have an attack coming in here. Now, this is where all that harass finally pays off as a very sophisticated tech comes in and smashes the more simplified army of just stalkers, doing a great amount of damage. And so Hero takes game number one.
Yeah, well done to Hero there. It felt like Zest was going to get an advantage, then he kept kind of fighting back, but the technicality of Hero winning out. Okay, our next map. This is kind of the most turtly map that there is.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of hoping it doesn't just turn into let's never get to 40 probes.
But, I think it might. I think it might be that.
Yeah.
I'm actually kind of expecting this one to be a real slugfest.
Same type of game.
Yeah. Okay, our players are now in the lobby. Again, the winner is going to face Sue in the winner's match.
Yes. And,
Yes. Good!
Yes.
Thunderbird, a map with a name straight out of the 80s, will be where game two takes place.
It's Acropolis, a map with a name out of the 400 BC, sir.
Yeah. All right, let's go.
Ocean Gaming, Zest.
Gaming in the water.
Seems like he's playing pretty well.
Triumphant Song Gaming, Hero.
Hero definitely with the clutch plays there. I wish that we could get back, though, our 2016 Hero, you know?
Well,
2016 Hero was such a badass in every way.
When he skateboarded to the studio and won, and skateboarded home with a check.
Swear to God,
he was so cool.
Yeah, he looked like the best player in the world that year.
I thought he was going to be. Yeah, I thought he was going to be the world champion. Keep dominating.
But you know, the prophecy came true, and Rogue took the championship that year. But I'd love to see him kind of return to that form. It's just since then he hasn't quite shined as brightly.
Well, he looked great in that game, but yeah, generally speaking, he seemed to not deliver the same kind of games that we saw in 2016.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like he has the same amount of depth either. He was playing every type of style that year.
Yeah.
Right now it's like he's kind of like back to old Hero a little bit. Like, his micro's very good. His execution's very good. He's very tricky and mind-gamey. But we don't see as much of the very solid macro Hero that we used to see, you know,
right,
where he could mix it up into anything.
Yeah, his timing attacks were so clean, too. Every strategy he would go for basically worked. And Zest's style of play, I almost have a harder time trying to put my finger on it. He had a few molds, a few archetype builds that he just had from A to Z perfectly mapped out.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, in my opinion, one of the best build order refiners that there
yeah.
is. He's
I think his weakness, though, is a lack of variety.
Sometimes it is. You're definitely right about that. Like, if you look at some of the periods where he did really well, like, remember him versus TY in that finals in 2016?
Right.
And he had that ridiculously dominating season. He kind of, like, invented an entire style/build in PVT and killed everybody with it, right? And that was really strong until people start to figure out how to kind of beat that a little bit. But yeah, I always think of him as someone who gets unbelievably good builds in execution. Like, he's going to have, you know, he has great mechanics and all that, too. But never really think of him as much as a mind-gamey type of guy. Like, he can hold his own, but I don't feel like he's going to pull the massive tricks.
Well, he's not trying to play around his opponent's play style. He's trying to react to it better. Does that make sense?
Kind of.
Like a Hero throws a lot of curveballs in his play.
Yeah.
It'll come kind of out of left field, hit you out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Where with, you know, Zest, it's like he's, I guess, trying to play a little bit more straight up.
Yeah.
But with a little bit more of a twist.
Kind of.
Trying to a lot of times prolong the game until he's at a spot where he can take it.
Yeah. He'll have it, like, mapped out just right. So, like, when your push comes, he has enough to crush it or something like that.
Yeah.
Right. Anyways, looking at this game right now, a Forge going down for a Hero. So this kind of tells us that he feels like this game is going to go on for quite some time. He's definitely right about that, as both sides are just kind of sitting back, making some sentries, getting their scouting done. There might be some light pokes, like these two Adepts coming in, for instance. But this is a game that looks like it's going to get pretty big.
Yeah, it seems to be on that trajectory where we're going to have a pretty dramatic macro game.
But look at the differences here, right? Okay, this Adept gets in, and it sees a Forge and a Robo. So we should see Zest probably add a Forge here.
Yeah.
I'd be kind of surprised if he didn't. But look at what else Hero's doing. This is the part that Hero's doing that's so different from what anyone else would do,
yeah.
And it's that Stargate.
And the funny thing is, I think, because normally hidden Stargates are much earlier in the game, there's a very high probability that Zest just discounts this as a possibility.
Yeah, you never really see him go Forge and Robo and then, like, a hidden Stargate at this point in the game. It's just, it's not really a thing.
We saw this phenomena happen, actually, later on in StarCraft 1, where if Protosses didn't go for a Reaver right away, he went for Reaver a little bit later. A lot of Terrans just weren't ready for it.
Yeah.
They just, like...
There's a window where it's supposed to come on most builds,
yeah.
And then if it comes at a different time, you get confused.
Yeah.
That exists a lot all over the place. There was a point in time where Widowmine drops were like that. Like,
yeah.
They would fall off after about 5 minutes. So if they come in, like, at that point, you're like, wait, what?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, what are
you're
you
not
doing?
Ready for it at all. Yeah.
You're supposed to be roaming with that medevac. What's going on? So... A Phoenix being made here. We did get a Prism out of Zest. So it seems like instead of making the game longer, he wants to harass right now. Just now adding the Forge.
Okay, now, incidentally, he might, when he's driven away from here, actually fly over that.
Well, the Phoenix is going to come in and just chase this down, I think.
Yeah. Unless he's going to hide it. I don't see the Phoenix coming down yet. So he actually... Okay, hold on.
Yeah,
he has to now. He might as well. And no recall for that, so that's just taken out. Not bad. Advantage Hero.
Yeah, but he's shown his tech here as well, hasn't he?
Oh, I like this hidden base down here in the bottom left.
Oh, my God. Yeah, okay.
Now, what's funny is it's a little bit counterintuitive because Phoenixes can scout more easily. If you have Phoenixes on the map and you're roaming, there's a higher chance you're going to spot something. But that base might be so far in the bottom left that is just going to be neglected territory by Hero.
You'll never shift-click your Phoenixes in a way that they're going to go over that unless you're looking for something like that.
And this could actually throw off the math here for Hero. Yeah. So I think Zest game, with a hit base like this, normally what you want to do is just stay back and let them try to attack on you and take the fight because you're going to get ahead in the Econ game.
Look at this, though. Double Robo. I believe we're going to see double Robo Disruptor now, right? Like, that must be what this is.
Yeah, I think you're probably right about that.
And you know what? If you're both going for, like, kind of the same ground pounding composition where it's like Archon, Immortal, Zealot.
Yeah.
If you have Disruptors in your army and they don't, you win that.
Yeah, yeah. It's not easy to split, particularly Immortals and Archons. And everything sort of clumps up so neatly with the way the SC2 AI operates.
Yeah. And when you think about it, right, like if you're the guy that adds the Disruptors in, your opponent will just go Phoenixes. But since Hero already has Phoenixes, it makes it a bit harder for Zest to go into Phoenixes, right? It's kind of like, oh, God, do I go Phoenixes? Because he's already ahead. So if he continues Phoenixes, then I get way behind.
Yeah. A great move here to fly in with these Phoenixes. Too much of the army on one control group there to deal with that, and so there wasn't any defense, so 9 probes killed. Not bad at all.
Dude, I like that Zest has taken this hidden base. That's really a smart location, and he's definitely he's gotten an edge via that, but I look at the game overall, and it feels like Hero's outdoing him, right?
Yeah.
He's ahead on the upgrades and on tech. Now, if he goes across the map and attacks, I think that's a huge blunder. I think he needs to wait longer, for sure.
Hold on, is that War Prism going to fly right into this army? All right, never mind. He's going to come in now, starting to push forward here. And let's see if he can actually hold this position up here. Again, because that base in the bottom left has stayed hidden, Hero basically has an incorrect assumption of where this game is at.
Yeah.
And this is where, no matter how many cool little fights you have, you can end up losing. But hold up here. First, these Disruptors are going to come in, and this attack has to be held off. That's what's most important here, is for Zest to try to drag this game out.
I mean, a fine hold from Zest, it didn't feel like that should really kill him, right? Like, if Hero just walks up this ramp and kills him, I don't know what to think. Maybe he's able to.
All right, he's starting to push in here now. Now, again, he can chuck out a few Disruptor shots here. Or if he does, okay, there we go. Nice, chipping away at those Immortals, both badly bruised. That might actually just be it. I think he's got enough here.
Maybe.
Look at that. Yeah. It's just 2 Archons here. He's going to have plenty more Disruptor shots for that.
What a peculiar game here from Hero.
He just owned him in that fight. That was crazy. Nicely done there by Hero. Is this going to be a new trend here? Is Hero going to be able to keep delivering like this?
I'm a little bit confused about exactly how and why that went down as it did. I know that Zest took that very fast base, so he was a little bit behind on units, but to attack up a hill in this situation with such a teched out army didn't feel like something that should be working. But I guess Zest kind of forewent a bunch of things, right? Like he had mostly very defending units, like he had his Immortals and Sentries and whatnot up on top of the ramp. But it's not like he did any sort of gateway explosion.
Right.
We didn't see a bunch of charge lots or something, that which can battle against that a bit better.
Up next, Sue versus Hero to decide who will move on to the round of 16. We'll go to that after this short break. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
wanna know what you think about me when the summer's over. Hey, yeah, it's been a blast. I still remember even after October. And when the winter falls, just think about me and I'll keep you. Change has to remain with thoughts of you, and I'm just not the same. I admit, like autumn, I'm falling for you. Wait, I don't wanna go. Time goes flying when you're wrapped in the moment. One more night, just follow me home. Tell me about all of your dreams. Just wanna know you. Let's pretend like the world ends today, 'cause tomorrow you'll be miles away. Oh, seasons have changed, I still remain with thoughts of you. And I'm just not the same.
진짜 오랜만에 하는데 그냥 재밌을 것 같고 아니 해봐야 될 것 같아요. 잘 모르겠어요 아직은. 아 약간 좀 과대평가된 것 같은데 전 스스로 좀 못한다고 생각하고 있고 아직 많이 부족해서 열심히 연습하고 있어요. 저는 32강을 통과하는 게 일단 목표고 저만 그런지 모르겠는데 연습하는데 힘들더라고요. 테란이 약한 것 같은데 저는 그래서 좀 힘들어서 일단 연습을 열심히 진짜 연습밖에 없는 것 같아요. 확실히 군입대라는 압박을 많이 받으실 것 같은데 갔다 오면은 다 재밌고 추억이니까 토스들 있잖아요. 92년생 토스 형들 좀 빨리 좀 갔으면 좋겠어요. 언제까지 그 종족 그걸로 해먹으려고 안 간지 모르겠는데
지난 시즌은 지긴 졌지만 배운 게 일단 너무 많은 리그였고 이번 시즌 하면은 그 배운 걸 바탕으로 좀 잘할 수 있을 거라는 자신감이 좀 많이 생겼어요. 일단 연습 방법이라든지 키보드를 안 까먹는 거라든지 그 말도 안 되는 거기 때문에 일단 대회하는 법 같은 걸 많이 깨달은 것 같아요.
제가 못해서 떨어진 거라서 그만큼 열심히 안 했으니까 떨어진 거고 그냥 항상 떨어지고 나서 후회를 하는 거죠. 좀 더 열심히 할 걸 이렇게.
그 지금 팬들은 이미 주선 선수의 우승을 점치고 있어요.
갑자기요?
진짜로. 요즘 꿈이 남다르다고.
그럼 몰랐는데 저도.
오랜만에 8강 한번 올라갔더니 좀 좋더라고요. 원래 16강에서 항상 떨어졌는데 오랜만에 좀 좋은 공기 마셨다. 이 정도로 하면 될 것 같아.
이 정도로 하면 될 것 같아.
원래는 깰 생각이 없었어요. 그래서 이제 애들한테 양보해주고 그랬고 영웅한테 이번 양보해주고 그랬는데 팬분들이 좀 원하더라고요. 그래서 이번 시즌에 하려고요.
아이엠이었던 것 같아요. 아이엠 우승했을 때 동기부여도 많이 돼서 그때 연습도 엄청 열심히 했던 것 같고 그런 결과 아이엠 3회 연속 우승까지 이뤘었고 그러면서 좀 자신감이 많이 붙었던 것 같아요, 그때 당시.
5년 전에 그 이제 SK랑 1라운드 결승 프로리그 할 당시에 그때 좀 올킬을 하면서 방송 경험도 이제 쌓이고 자신감도 붙으면서 좀 뒤에 이제 리그가 좀 잘 풀렸던 것 같아요. 약간 터닝 포인트 그런 느낌?
IEM 우승하기 전에는 세상이 흑백으로 보였어요. 우승하고 나서는 색감이 이제 좀 보이더라고요. 아 그만큼 이제 좀 행복해졌다.
G1에 입단한 게 제일 큰 터닝포인트였던 것 같고 팀에서 일단 많이 배워서 스스로 많이 성장했다 생각하고 또 다른 터닝포인트는 이제 군입된 것 같아요 사실 뭐 다시 게임을 할 생각이 없었는데 군대에서 생각이 많이 나더라고요 스타트가 가끔 휴가 나와서 GSL 보면 아 나도 했었는데 이러면서 되게 재밌어 보이고 군입 때 전에 솔직히 많이 놀았거든요 게임도 안 하고 근데 이제 다시 열정이 살아나서 열심히 계속 해볼 생각이에요
시즌2에서 령우랑 했던 거 너무 시간을 되돌리고 싶고 령우만 아니었다면 이런 생각도 들기도 하고 또 령우한테도 좀 자신감이 있었기도 했고 그래가지고 진짜 너무 아쉬웠던 순간인 것 같아요
솔직히 부러운 사람들이 있으면 없어요 아니 솔직히 성적 잘 내고 뭐 커리어 좋고 한 거 부러운데 솔직히 군대 또 가기가 싫어가지고
김세경 선수 아, 옛날부터 너무 팬이고 외모도 잘생기시고 그냥 김태경 선수밖에 안 떠오르는 것 같아요 그 최근에 상금 랭킹을 보는데 세랄이 그렇게 뜬 지가 얼마 안 됐는데도 되게 엄청 높더라고요 보면서 아 내가 14년도에 다 우승했으면 내가 저기 있을 텐데 그런 생각이 들더라고요
All right, it's time for the winner's match. Sue vs. Hero is about to start. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I just feel like Sue is supposed to win this, right?
He is absolutely supposed to, but Hero said during that interview he learned a lot last season. He's feeling really confident again. I tell you, he just played very well against Zest, who is a deadly PvP player.
True, very true. Yeah, let's see how this goes. I think it's hard to really get a good evaluation of where Sue's at just today because of, I don't know where Dream was really at. Do you know what I'm saying? Dream had some interesting games that he played against Sue. They were pretty dramatic. We might have a small delay here. One of our players has not joined the lobby yet. We'll see if that gets fixed in a second. But I'm not sure what to expect here. One thing I am confident about is that Hero is probably going to be trying to execute the style that's worked for him in the past. Probably a lot of timing attacks. Probably a lot of...
He has very tricky PvZ builds overall. He's really brought a lot to the table that matchup, even in recent times, where he hasn't been like doing as well as what we kind of expect from him. You know, normally he's a player that... at least in the past, it's like a top four is not unreasonable. Here, it's kind of been like, oh, you made a top eight. Wow, that's actually okay, finally. But yeah, he's been bringing out quite a few different builds. Definitely a lot of very strong timing attacks and some tricky plays as well, like in Immortal into two-star Phoenix, that type of thing. So I think it's going to be a little bit hard for Sue in that regard. But if Sue can get the game to just go a little bit longer, I think he's going to take
control. I do agree with you on that point. I think that Sue is... overall, just like a better RTS player in a long game. Like, he makes better late-game decisions. I feel like Hero's strongest point is actually almost right in the mid-game. You know, that's usually where he's either doing his timing attack then, or he's whatever tricks and traps that he laid out early on have worked for him, and then he's able to come in and do the damage he needs to do.
Yeah, like, before we're hitting 60 drones or something, let's say, it's going to be Hero-favored, and then after that it should be a little bit more Sue-favored, probably.
Do you expect this to be typical of PvZ, where it's going to be a lot of very specific timing attacks or something to try to come in there and just throw the Zerg off? The Zerg's just trying to be honest and play a normal game, unless Sue does something crazy. But
well, Zergs have been cheesy and aggressive lately. Dark has kind of ushered that in.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think that the last thing that we're going to want to see from Hero is a reactive game with a Stargate opener. Like, if he does something like that, I feel like that's just Sue's playground. That's where Sue is going to be able to do exactly what he wants, get into the position he wants to. Now, I'm not saying that Stargate is off the table. You can definitely open Stargate, but if you're going, like, Stargate, Archon Drop, Third Base, Psy Storm, try to push with Immortals and plus two, I feel like that's where Sue really knocks him on his butt.
I don't think Hero... So the lights are a little bit bright. I think it's actually Hero that's not in the game yet. It's kind of weird that we have some kind of a delay considering he just played a game. So I don't know what the deal is, but we might have to kill a little bit more time up here. It is cool to see Hero playing pretty well, though. Then again, I don't know if Zest is a great
measurement for where Hero's at. You know what I'm saying?
Could there be a better measurement than beating Zest, one of the greatest protoss of all time? Or
but I don't think he's been playing as well lately. You know, I feel like...
Well, he hasn't really won championships, but I mean...
Yeah.
He's playing well.
Well,
you can't
play that well,
game.
Artosis. He did die in that game. He did get Hulk smashed by him.
He did die, yeah.
You know,
no, it's Hero played better.
Yeah.
In that series.
But Sue is looking very, very hot right now.
Yeah.
He's looking really on top of his game.
He declared he's going to win this season, which is
so
not
crazy.
Something that Sue ever really does.
Yeah.
You know, he's jinxed himself so many times, I guess, at this point, right? 6 second places in GSL.
Do you think he's being a little bit tongue-in-cheek about that, though? Is he just...
I don't think he's ever said something that wasn't tongue-in-cheek, to be honest.
Yeah.
He's one of the more sarcastic players in that
room. You kind of have to be if you're going to survive the kind of career that Sue's had, which is he's been so close so many times and then does not quite deliver. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, I think he's definitely got the right mindset coming into this. And still, no player. We're still waiting. Apparently now it's going to be – I was just informed it was an issue with sound. So
exciting. All right.
Let's go.
Yeah. But look, Sue is the guy that you really expect to get out of the group.
I think at this
point, looking at how everyone's playing, it seems very hard to see Dream get out. And he even said the same type of thing that Bomber said, where he's like, yeah, I'm not quite ready yet. Like, people are saying you're good, Dream. What do you think about that? Not yet.
he looks like he's a good RTS player, but he's not really up to date with maybe the way the current meta should be played. He came out with some very... original and unique strategies, but they did not work out at all.
No.
Especially in game one, where he successfully hid the two additional barracks very early on in the back of his main. It was never scouted. And when the army pushed out, Sue's like, what? And just kills it off. Which seems to make the strategy, it makes the strategy look obsolete. Like, that's not even really a thing. You know, sometimes players can have ideas, but at the highest level, those ideas are just bunk. It's just not going to work against top-tier players.
Yeah. Well, you know, and now he's got to play against a Protoss player and then quite likely a Protoss player after that. And I think that during his interview you could kind of pick up that maybe he's feeling that matchup's a little bit difficult right now.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess we'll see with that. As far as this goes, did we show the map lineup yet? I don't believe that we did.
I don't believe we've seen it yet. It's King's Cove for map one, but I don't know what the next two maps are going to be.
Well, that actually makes it more interesting, I think, for a map one, because this is one of the maps where things like Immortal pushes are not anywhere near as strong. King's Cove is a map where we get a lot of very long games.
Yeah.
Now, there have been some really interesting ZVP styles that have been appearing, even with Mutalisk play mixed in there after some Roach Ravagerling type of situations. So I'll be very excited if we see something like that from Sue. If you recall... some of Sue's very powerful earlier ZVPs when he was first making GSL Finals did include moves like that, like Mutas into Roaches. That was kind of the era where we saw that a lot already. So wondering if we could see something like that in King's Cove.
It'd be nice. I'm looking forward to it. It's got to be kind of a jarring for Hero. You know, he's playing pretty well here, but now he's got some kind of weird tech problem he's dealing with here. Sue, though.
At least he remembered his keyboard this time, so.
I can't believe that story, man. It's so crazy. Forgetting
just,
his...
I'm wondering.
How do you have.
I like that he laughs about it, but, like, it is. It's.
You'd have to be so out of it to be a GSL player and not. I mean, this is, like, what you do is GSL if you're a StarCraft II pro in Korea. You know, this is, like, the main thing. And then to leave your house without the keyboard is such a. I don't know what was going on with that.
I'm trying to figure out what that's like. Like, do you just have a backpack that's really light? You're like, wow, I must be getting stronger from going to the gym because my backpack's so light today.
Yeah.
He's got a
backpack
where
he never checks what's inside or something.
Because
it's like
me
in school when I was a kid.
There's no way you don't play a warm-up game before you go, right? You're playing GSL.
You would assume so, yeah.
So you sit there, you play your warm-up game, then you type your practice sprint. You're like, okay, I got to go. And then you just get up, turn around, and walk out of the house.
Okay, I think we finally sorted it out. Here we go.
New Repugnancy and Turbo Cruise.
We're getting all the maps in here.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Actually, not surprised to see that. Yeah, it seems like a strong veto from Sue to get rid of Thunderbird there. Even though we've seen Dark with some success there. A lot of Zergs feeling that's a pretty Protoss favorite map. Okay. Let's see it, man.
Okay. The game has started. The countdown started, I should say. Sue versus Hero. Sue having a pretty strong performance so far. In 2019, we're really looking to see if Hero can bring back the player that we knew from 2016 here in this current year. In this best of three, the winner will move on to the round of 16. Let's go.
Chivo, Sue. Triumphant Song Gaming, Hero.
Triumphant Song Gaming.
Yeah. And Ocean Gaming and Chivo and Brave Stars Gaming.
Triumphant Song is like whatever the jingle is when you win in a Japanese RPG.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. That actually might be it.
Yeah.
I could see that. Some very interesting team names from the Chinese team scene.
Yes. Okay. So far, pretty standard stuff here between these two guys. Looking at the record of these two players. Wow, Sue really dominating him in Legacy of the Void. But
yeah.
Also, just a winning record overall. I actually thought it would be a little bit closer than that, but I guess
yeah.
Considering, you know, Sue is in some ways probably eliminated more people in GSLs than almost anybody else.
Yeah, that's,
when you think about how well he's done and how many finals he's been to.
That's actually a very good point. I believe that the I heard a stat that like the most wins in GSL actually is SOS. I'm not 100% sure on that, but like...
Really? In GSL, it's SOS?
I believe
he has
the most wins in GSL.
If that's true, I'm really surprised. I feel like that can't be, but then...
But when you look at it, right, like, Sue has gotten far so many times, Innovation far so many times. These are kind of the players that are really, really high up there. And Sue, I mean, obviously with six finals, he had six seasons where, like, he beat basically everybody. So he has to be up there as well. Anyways, it is a Stargate opener here. Not super surprised to see that on King's Cove, because, you know, if you try to do something like a Robo opener, you're just shooting yourself in the foot. It's very hard to get aggressive on this map in that way. But with the Stargate opener, you do have some options, right? You can go into one of those bigger macro games, which I think is what Sue would be very comfortable with. But there's other builds, too. Like, for instance, you could go for a Glaives build behind this, or a... I mean, the charge builds are pretty gone. Glaives builds are pretty popular at the moment. But he's trying to do something maybe slightly tricky because he is making that Stalker. And when you see the Stalker, you wonder, is there a Stargate?
Yeah, it can usually telegraph some form of, you know, deception. I don't want to get spotted or scouted right away. Phoenix is about to come out now.
Yeah, is he going to actually send the Phoenix immediately to kill the Overlord?
Looks like it, yeah. Okay. He's going to come and get rid of this immediately.
Yeah, he's not trying to be too sneaky or anything.
Yeah, Zerg's just staying back and droning up as much as he can. It's been a pretty passive game to start things off. We have two gases being taken. Just one being taken. There it is, the second one, over at the natural. Mm-hmm. Immediately after that, Overlord's killed, so he could not be scouted. Protoss trying to create as much ambiguity as possible about what his true intentions are here. Mm-hmm.
So a second Oracle gets started right away. Nothing too crazy.
Yeah, this is all very textbook.
Yeah. There has been kind of a resurgence of these, like, 3-4 Oracles in the early game against Zerg. I believe Classic was the first one we saw doing that in recent times, just kind of flying around killing drones
in big
for
tournament
a very
matches,
long time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, nice catch right here.
Oh, and actually the denial there on the Extractor. Oh, my God, he's actually not quite splitting correctly, but he still does get kills on that. Five kills, and the Oracle is going to get out.
Is it?
Yes.
Oh,
okay, yeah,
gosh.
He does. Yeah.
Yeah. Five kills is really, really nice there. Really nice. Okay, so Forge, Robo, and Twilight on the way. We should be seeing a three-base build here from Hero. See if he goes into Archon drops. Would not be surprised about that. But with the Forge. Oh, and another Oracle
like
as well.
So
look
continuing
at that.
To pull this. Mm-hmm. Some nice masking, though. Just has that one come out. So we're going to see a lot more damage come in here right away. Three paired up at once.
Yeah, that's cool.
Now, the Overlord's going to come in here and try to scout. A really well-timed Stalker is warping in the main to try to deny that.
But really, even if you scout this, you're not going to know what that these oracles are coming. There's nothing that you could come in here and look for.
They actually just flew over his Zergling, so I think he's going to be able to move his queens into a decent position. But with a lift and three oracles, you are going to get a lot of drone kills here before you lose them all. Hopefully the hurt one's in the back and not the one on the right there.
Yeah, he should have it the properly rotated. Right. Oh, wow.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of the one that's most likely to be hit first because it's slightly in the lead.
Okay, he rotates that over there. Yeah. Great targeting. That's actually a little bit weird with the queen picked up like this. It's harder to click on those drones.
Yeah, it
is. But coming in there, and I don't think he's finished yet. He's going to get a few more kills.
Yeah, that flyby didn't do quite as much as I think he was looking for, but eight drones is really legit as well to lose only one oracle there.
Yeah, and he'll have those two remaining oracles to tag the army in. Keep checks on what's going on. There's a third base that's been taken as well, or it's being taken, excuse me. And it appears that Hero's just setting up for a very proper late game here.
Yeah.
There's nothing fancy. I really expected something a little bit different, but so far Hero looks great.
And I know I was kind of saying that I think that this plays into Sue's hands a little bit, and I do think it does a little bit, but this map, again, it's really hard to kill someone on this map. It's very easily defensible. And with the amount of damage that he's done with his Oracle Harassment, I think that gives him a really reasonable shot here, even though we are going into that kind of macro game. He can't be unhappy with his opening.
No, this is looking great.
Eventually, you just have to be happy about something. This opening is one of those things. So, Hydraling Bane looks like it is going to be the unit set of choice here for Sue. Very strong set of units, really what you want to get into here as Zerg.
Yeah, tempo-wise, these guys are both keeping a nice pace here. I wouldn't say anybody's clearly ahead of the other. I mean, Hero's had some successful harasses, but he did suffer some losses in that process.
Yeah.
And I don't think the Zerg is going to be limping through the mid-game here anymore.
No, he's catching his stride at the moment. We're up at a reasonable amount of workers. He's still adding some in there as well, getting his Baneling speed. Sending that creep spread out, that's very, very important here as well.
And I don't think there's anything that really incentivizes the Zerg to attack the Protoss here.
No.
On this map specifically, it's like, you're pretty safe on three bases.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to attack up the hill here, you're either going to throw the game or you were so far ahead, there was like four different ways you could have won this game. So, probably don't want to see that. Saint Robo coming up. Hero is really getting himself set up here for this, for a very strong mid to late game.
So Psystorm is on the way. Again, the Oracles are going to try to come through here. Not going to be enough.
Yeah. And Sue's doing exactly what he needs to do, which is take one additional base. It'll be interesting to see if he waits to try to pounce on a fourth base of Hero here.
Okay, and we're probably going to have that as the next
speed
raid. Because I was going to say, I mean, I feel like trying to attack it to the third or the second would really be an exercise in futility. I mean, it's just such a box-off location with Hydra Bane versus Force Fields and Psystorm, it's like you're never going to win that fight. That's the Protoss's dream, is to have you attack him there, where the fourth base is actually a very wide and open area.
Yeah.
You can get a lot of very good angles in here to attack. Now, Hero, being cognizant of this, has already set up some booby traps on the map to try to stun the Banes as they come in so he can dice up the armies and pick his fights accordingly.
Yeah, now look at this. He's clearing out these rocks, which I think is amazing. Sue wants flow with his units right now, and he is teching up immediately into Broodlords, which is smart. But if he decides to really go with this attack, I think he needs to keep it up for a little bit. You need to reduce these high-tech units, which will make Hero replace them, which will slow down him getting into Tempest. And if you can nail all that, then a Broodlord push on that fourth base could be a game-ender.
Yeah, that's a great way to close it out. Now, when this attack starts to happen, we really want to watch and see how and what the Banelings connect to in the fight, because the Banelings are the initial burst damage, and then the Hydras are there to start to clean up the weakened, softened units with that high DPS they have here.
Yeah, right now, it seems like he's playing a defensive style overall, right? He's got a decent crease spread. He's going to stay probably in a bit of a concave. Looks like he might utilize the high ground a little bit here as well. That could be a smart move. Oh, I kind of like that. Setting up some stasis wards as he goes. That allows him to...
Oh, that was not a great stasis there. Good side storms on both sides. The Templar is still completely untouched.
Yeah, like a kind of
an intelligent flank there, but Hero was super duper ready. Look at this, immediately with the warp in the main base.
Yeah, Hero handling this with such grace, not overextending either. There's so many zealots here in the main doing tons of damage, and the push continues over here towards the fourth.
Oh my god, there's so many immortals in there right now. He's gonna go ahead and try to flank this. A lot of Lings and Banes get on top of those high Templar.
Completely annihilates that army.
Oh my god.
The Hydra's just decimating those immortals.
All the important units there going down. The Greater Spire is not in the main base, so even though these zealots are doing some pretty big damage,
oh my god,
they're not gonna get the most important
kill one of these buildings.
He's not gonna kill anything, is
no.
he?
No.
Everything in the red. If you were Terran, you'd have to repair these.
yeah, I mean, damaging a hive is like definitely not some mission objective in this fight. This is really bad for Hero now. His Robotech has been totally reset. Those immortals he was making the entire game back down to zero now.
His Templars are gone too. It's a terrible situation. You know what? Hero, like, he was playing an almost amazing game, or he was playing an amazing game until that last part. Because keeping your army near Sue's fourth base and acting like it's going to attack is insanely powerful because it buys your zealots in the main base a lot of extra time, right? But then he actually attacked. And that's like you're attacking on creep against Ling Bane Hydra, and you don't actually have the full army there anymore. And as soon as you lose the technicality of your army, it allows these Broodlord pushes to just get you. You have to replace those units or you die to Ling Bane Hydra, which means you can't really get into Tempest. He has no bank. He doesn't have Tempest tech. He's making immortals against Broodlords right now. That's exactly what we're seeing. He doesn't even have Blink. This is a terrible situation
for
Hero.
Oh, God, that's a good point. Yeah, in fact, he just now starts Blink here.
Yeah, that's kind of what you do in a situation like this. But that's going to be very, very late.
Okay, well, we have a pretty ambitious push coming in here. Let's see how much damage this can actually do. Again, the Hydra is doing so much damage back there. We need to see some more Psystorms storms here. Now, Broodlings or Broodlords, excuse me, are very well positioned on the high ground here, which basically makes Protoss having any foothold in this position on the map an impossibility.
Yeah, this is very tough. He's going to have to start trying to harass at the sides and whatnot.
Oh, good surround here.
Oh, man.
We need a recall or something if he gets a few more Lings to just catch this.
I don't think he even has time.
Oh, my God.
Such a tough situation. He brings up his stalkers, but again, Blink not quite ready.
Yeah.
In this type of situation, like, the army of Sue cannot be beaten right now.
Yeah, unless Sue is to overextend here, stroll out of his base and just get out positioned. Blink about 70% finished.
I tell you.
Oh my god.
I don't know about this move up right now.
Oh, here we go.
Well, I guess he is hitting before Blink.
Thing is, if he keeps the Banelings underneath the Broodlords, then Blink is just like, okay.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
So.
Yeah.
Okay, great dodging here. He's baited out enough of these Psy Storms. We're getting to the point where he's going to have to commit. Again, Blink so close to finishing.
Yeah, it's getting right up there. Some good Psy Storms do go down.
10 seconds out. The Banes are not being left under the Broodlords, so maybe he's got a shot, but this is a lot of damage. And in fact, I don't even know if they, I think that at this point in time, oh, it's actually a blink away from the Bane, so this is almost a certainty that this Nexus is going to be taken down.
Yeah. Wow, what a great game this was, though, really. I feel like this, he blinks for that
team.
I feel like this game is such a great game to learn from because they both did beautiful, like, you know, en garde, touche, you know, this type of thing. Wow. My speaking skills are going way down right now. But, you know, it's one of these games where it was tit for tat. They went back and forth. They both made a lot of brilliant moves. And then Hero overcommitted on creep with his main army. If you pull that main army back, you don't have to rebuild it. He can easily get into Tempest to deal with the Broodlords. Of course, that can get tricky too if you want to go into that late game because Zerg is a bit favored when they get into the real late game.
Right.
But losing that whole army, he didn't have any real options for continued harassment or anything. You know, it really throwing that army away is what lost the game.
Let's go into game two. Now, I want to point something out. We were mentioning this earlier on, but look, Hero, he's an excellent player. He's one of the best players there is, but he does not have the best end game. And we saw that back there. He had actually had everything set up right. He's very good, especially with his builds. His builds are very, very sharp. And he definitely knows what he's doing and why he's doing it, but I don't know if he should be playing late game against Sue. Does this kind of music, does this feel like it's like kind of from our childhood?
Yeah. That's why it's so good.
Yeah.
The music I like is the best music.
Yeah. Sue. Triumphant Song Gaming. Hero.
We got an echo in the GSL voice.
Hero. Bro.
Okay, immediate probe scout here.
Yeah, I'm gonna just find the hatchery already down. Maybe he's gonna fake a cannon rush or something. Yeah, kinda.
Yeah, there's no forge here. The Overlord's now coming back.
It's always nice to mix in this kind of fakeness because then, you know, I think that people have started to catch on that, like, for instance, SOS. Okay, he'll run up and he'll make a pylon. You know what, how you know SOS is going to cannon rush? Is in one of the earlier games in the series, he puts a pylon near your hatchery.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's how you know later on in the series he's going to cannon rush.
Because SOS is one of the players where all the build orders are connected in a series to actually outthink you.
Yeah. SOS is a spider, and he just builds this amazing giant web where he feels all the tingles at the edges, and he knows when there's an ant.
Ooh, I like that. You poet. So the probe is body blocking what would ideally be the third base. The pylon will continue to deny the presence of that.
Yeah, kind of nice. We'll see if Sue wants to take the other base. Yeah, it cancels that pylon, goes back. Aha, the robo. So he'll be doing probably an immortal in, all in on this map.
Just an immortal in.
Yeah.
You know. That's what you should call it when it's not an all in. It's just like an in. Well, he's going to go forward.
He's going to be immortal in.
Yeah. Well, I actually think this has a higher chance of going better for Hero because the other kinds of builds, you probably. Well, I mean, just more standard play. I just don't feel like that's Hero's niche. I understand that as a player, you know, you're trying to get all the different approaches kind of hammered down here. I mean, one thing that is so scary since we were talking about SOS earlier is the fact that he can kind of just do anything and it's going to go well. He can play totally insane or he can just be a very standard style. Did that not scout that?
It did scout it.
It did scout it. Okay. But, you know, I think Hero, if he's going to beat Sue here, he needs to go into more timing attack-oriented games where he can really utilize how great his control is and how tactically superior he is to a lot of the other players he plays against.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it because I would say that tactically he kind of outplayed Sue in that previous game.
Yeah.
It's just he made one wrong decision with your army, and a lot of times that's going to cost you the game. Now, the robo was scouted, right? This makes me wonder if you switch it up. Okay, he's adding three gates right now. He is making it more. Okay, he keeps adding gates. I guess not. I guess we're not really going to see a switch up here. Is this just going to be like a one immortal timing?
Yeah, why not?
Because he's not getting extra gases. He's not really doing much anything. If you're not going to get sentries or charge or glaives, just go. You know, you're not waiting. What are you waiting on? If you're going to get a second immortal, you may as well get an upgrade with it.
Yeah.
Right?
No, I think it's going to be a very tight timing where he's just going to come out and start swinging. And do we have that War Prism out on the map yet? I believe he's just now beginning the push. Yeah, here we go.
Okay.
And so this is going to be a very early attack. As the Roach Warren finishes, let's watch and see what exactly is going to be made here by Sue.
Roaches.
And how many he's going to have, though, because that one immortal here, we want to watch that very carefully.
Yeah, he's making a lot of stalkers here as well, so obviously that's going to be helpful against these incoming roaches. Not that many lings out right now.
He's and immediately the attack starts. Yeah, it appears that he's sacking this, at least for now.
Well, this is so all in by Hero. He's got so few probes. He doesn't have gases at his natural, you know?
Right.
What you see is what you get. Hero's not planning for retirement right now.
Okay, nicely done. He isolates the two queens. So they're most certainly going to be taken out. The glaives are now going to be, I'm sorry, not the glaives, the vials right now are being used to combat force fields and not to try to snipe off the warp prism.
He's going to be able to pick off this hatchery pretty easily.
And that's just step one of winning this game.
Yeah.
But he needs to get a little bit further than this.
Look at that, though. Actually, a nice surround there with those broodlings. Fortunately, he's losing a big chunk of his production with that hatchery going down.
The immortal's still in good shape.
Throwing on those vials, making him reposition a little bit. Some more Lings coming back right now.
He has not had another warp in just yet. Ooh, actually hits with the bile right there. Look at that. He starts the other hatch knowing that this has been held.
Yeah.
That's some confidence.
It's like, get out of here. The only thing he wishes here is that Hero could see the ghost image of the hatchery to know how confident Sue is. Can you imagine how bad, Mare, that would be if you could see ghost images of things that were going to be built? That would be like dropping mules are for Terran. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I just like ghost Nexus, like
you're
five
like
Nexus in
this
your
guy's
face.
Like, I've already got this.
Yeah. Get out of here.
Get up. Okay. Well, this is actually going nicely. It looks like Hero's going to try to redirect the game into more economy play. He's continuing to make two probes at a time. He's going to fly around the map with two Immortals in the Warp Prism to try to just snipe off whatever he can get.
Yeah, you have to do something like this.
Yeah, I mean, if you have it, you better use it, right? Mm. Now, I don't believe we're going to have any major warp-ins or any kind of pushes with this because it's going to be very easy for a Ravagers to snipe this down. Actually, you know what? No, let me take that back. He's actually moving out again. Hmm. He's made a few more probes, but then he stopped again. He's just making a few more gateways here and making Immortals. So he wanted just like a total of four more probes, and then he's going to try to do a second all-in.
He's actually adding a Forge.
Oh,
so
then never mind.
We might get it even longer. It seems that way.
It's just odd because he started probes and he stops and he makes a Forge. It's like, okay, what do you want exactly here?
Yeah, he's kind of all over the place with that. That's for sure. Lings actually pick off that probe that was at the base, so that kind of hiccups any strategy for moving forward here. You know, the one thing I guess that he's doing very well is forcing more and more units to be made by Sue rather than workers.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I just wonder if he's like forcing so many units that he's, you know, maybe the attack can actually kill him. But there is a prism with Immortals.
Nice counterattack here with these Lings. Fortunately for Hero, he does have an army down here that can drive this away. And so Protoss is going to be getting a third base here.
Sometimes it's just funny to see how much is attacking Immortals. And you're like, no, we have this barrier thing. It's
they're
really
like, neat. We have shields too. It's
We actually have decent health and a prism to get us out of here. So
you wouldn't believe how much damage we can take here.
And deal.
Okay, the Lings will once again try to come in here for a counter. Clearly, though, Hero is already prepared. And we have probes being made again. This is so funny how he's kind of gone back and forth with what he's been trying to do. But
he's like a sine wave of probes.
Yeah. He's like zigzagging in and out of economy play while he's harassing. Well, I mean, Sue is not stopped making roaches, and he's continuing to get more Ravagers here. And it looks like Sue wants to try to seesaw this into a counterattack. Now, where's that War Prism? I actually cannot find it. Oh, I think it's actually flying back home. I thought this would be a good moment to try to drop there, but I guess when you have this many roaches and Ravagers, you probably need all the Immortals you can get in one place.
If he doesn't have, if he doesn't have this Prism, he's not going to hold this.
Whoa!
Yeah, slowing everything down. He needs to will down a bunch of this. Because right now it's going to be very hard to actually dodge these vials. Vials coming down. He's doing a decent job dodging, but he does get hit a few times.
Yep, loses one of those. The shield batteries are only going to be a temporary thing here to try to get him to sustain in this fight.
God, Sue pushing forward so much. We have those unpowered shield batteries in the front. Really painful to see, but look how many Immortals he has!
Oh my God, he's continuing to press through. But yeah, as long as the Immortals are alive, you have to assume that Protoss has a real shot.
Oh my God, five Immortals being juggled.
Okay, there's still more roaches being made here. Again, it's hard to juggle all these in here, but it looks like Hero's actually holding this off.
Yeah, just pushing forward now with these five Immortals. Can you imagine Protoss being played by Archons? Like if Zest had a Prism here and Hero had a Prism here?
Okay, I mean,
it's
again,
ridiculous.
He needs more beefy units here to try to push through here. I mean, you can see that the pendulum sort of swing back over is that's it. GG, Hero wins. The counterattack from Sue has failed.
Wow. He was so all in with that first push, but he did get the hatchery. Sue with a stronghold. But the counterattack, you know, he kept up the harassment and everything. Hero kind of skated the line, making units. Seems like he could have attacked if Sue did not make enough units. And then Sue decided to pull the trigger. Unable to break through, though. Really nice micro from Hero there at the end.
Yeah. Okay, so Hero's got a real shot. Mm-hmm. Despite the counter, the type and attack, not working. He kind of put Sue in a position where Sue really just continued to try to mass produce, and Sue thought, wait a minute, okay. If you're taking a third base, I should be able to kill it. But, you know, there were so many probes cut there by Hero.
Yeah.
I think one of the things I want to do in the future of Hero's games that I cast is really try to watch when he starts and stops probes.
He had 31 probes during his first push.
So crazy.
31.
But then he made four, and then he stopped again. He's like, ah, I'm crazy.
Yeah.
So Sue is not able to get a good read. Let's go to a map that's fun to say. Turbo Cruise 84.
Fight.
What kind of cruise?
You just wait.
Fastest type of cruise.
Chivo, Sue.
This is the whole thing is like people, there's whole eras where all the bands from that era kind of sing in the same way, you know?
Yeah. It was a good time.
It was a good time.
Triumphant Song Gaming, Hero.
Then there was bands like Bush, and it was like...
Oh, yeah. Quite a few bands.
You can't have
like
bands where they go... You can't have that anymore.
Like
that's
Creed,
not a thing.
Bush.
And then there was the and then there was like the punk bands.
Oh, yeah.
StarCraft. I can't even do the voice. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Oh, of course.
Yeah.
I still listen to all that stuff.
Yeah.
I literally have a playlist on my computer called 2002.
Are you serious?
I am not even joking. I just went through. Yeah. I spent a lot of time recultivating all my... Because I had all my music when I moved to Korea on... I got one of those really old iPods because I moved here in 2008.
Yeah.
Right? And I had all my music on it, but I didn't have a computer, right? So that was all my music.
Yeah.
And then I eventually... Like, it fell out of my pocket at the airport or something. And, like,
oh,
I lost
no.
it. So I didn't have music for years, but I have regained. And now I listen to my 2002 playlist while I play StarCraft 1, released in 1998.
We know the best times of Artosis' life are right there.
I'm like Fry from that Futurama episode where he has the anchovies.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I only like old things.
Yeah.
I don't like change, Tasteless.
No. No, Artosis. You don't have to change. It's
I
okay.
wish we were just playing Daybreak still. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I just wish every...
Super Nintendo was the best console, okay?
Well, that part's true.
Yeah. That was a good console.
Yeah.
A good console. Did you ever have that when you were in school? You know, all the nerds would sit at the lunch table, and then there'd be the guys who would talk about which console was better, and it was totally based off which ones their parents bought them for Christmas, because you're like
right.
in middle school, and obviously you can't afford to have your own console.
Yeah, well, I didn't experience those conversations, but yeah.
You didn't hang out with... Oh, no, you were actually supposed to be like a cool kid when you were younger, right? You like skateboarded and stuff?
I don't know. Maybe a little bit.
Well, but you're a little bit
I was
cool
a little
guy.
Nerd, a
yeah,
little
yeah.
cool.
A little bit cool.
I hung out with cool kids and nerds.
Wow.
Yeah.
A true renaissance kid, huh?
Yeah, maybe. And then I found StarCraft
yeah.
and didn't hang out with anybody.
Yeah, and started failing out of school. And okay, here comes that first adept.
Ooh.
Ooh. He almost didn't get to set up. I'll get you later, drone.
I wonder what the plan is here. A lot of times right now, I feel like I've seen this map vetoed. I feel like it's a pretty decent map for Protoss, really.
Yeah, some of these players are just not having it on this map, so.
I've seen a lot of cheesy play on this map. Not very many games just go like the full distance in a macro. You don't see Hive here that often. I've seen neither a Tempest nor a Carrier here.
Yeah. So the Overlord does get in. That first Phoenix will kill that off, but already some scouting here. I don't know why I thought players were going to try to play around that
green stuff.
That green thing, yeah, that slows them down.
You have to walk so far around to go
yeah,
around it.
Yeah.
Like, I see Zerg walk around it with bigger armies later on. I
yeah.
think you kind of need to. Because, like, imagine walking through that and they force field you. It's just like, okay, well.
The Lings still look pretty fast when they run through it, though, you know?
Well, yeah, I guess Lings are pretty fast.
Yeah, they're
tasteless.
Pretty quick units, yeah.
It's a really good. Yeah, look at that. The Phoenix, which is also fast, you know, looks
yeah.
pretty fast going
yeah.
through still.
It's not so
not
bad.
Not like as fast, but like, you know.
It's pretty quick.
Like pretty quick, yeah.
Yeah. So that
still faster than like a queen off creep or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Let's get a queen to walk through and just watch.
I know.
Yeah.
Did you see that screenshot of the fungal concussive shell time warped immortal walking through the,
no.
the green things?
I did not
it's
see
like
that.
Minus 99.7% speed or something like that. It was on Reddit. It was so funny. My God.
Oh, I gotta see that.
It's
I gotta
like
see that
just. It was like just a screenshot. I'd love to see an actual video of it trying to make it through, though. Yeah.
Okay, five gates coming down. And Zealot legs with that Templar Archives.
Yeah. So I guess this looks like it's going to be an immortal charge build, is it?
Let's do it.
Right? I mean, not immortal. Archon charge, sorry,
right.
Of course. Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty reasonable build. A lot of roaches being made, though, right?
You want to just go for that third over there? Or is there any
I don't think
sense
you're gonna,
going for the natural?
I don't think it's really going to work that well. Just because, like, he's already made 10 roaches, right? So you're kind of already starting to hold it a little bit. He's poking here, trying to see what's happening. This is kind of a nice move by a hero moving out to the third base right now. It's kind of giving a little bit of disinformation to him. Okay, he's moving out. Here we go. Uh-oh.
Ooh, here we go. Oh, Link's getting inside, though.
Double
and
uh-oh.
A recall. And, oh, that's cute. Okay,
yeah,
just three adepts. I was wondering, I thought there's no way he's going to recall the whole
God.
Army back here. Whoa, okay,
he's
shoving.
Everything.
All right, the Zealots can't quite get the ideal surface area. Good pickup there, disabling that one queen. Dropping the Archons on the other side to hit those Ravagers.
Beautiful moves right there. Look at that, another warp in instantaneously here. Spore coming up for the flank against the Prism, but he will move it out of there. It draws three Zealots to the side, though, and that's a non-trivial amount of Zealots. He would love to have those down in this actual battle that matters.
Okay, he's actually going to be able to pick off this queen now.
Don't forget, he lost 14 probes during all this, though.
Yeah, well, I think he might have enough momentum, though.
Yeah.
I might be wrong, but it seems like Hero's doing the damage. The Archons are still alive.
I think you're right. There's only seven roaches out right now.
Wow. Okay, the drones are being pulled, and that's where this Archon splash is going to be a nightmare.
Yeah.
Very this is the tipping point.
Here.
He did it.
Seems that way.
I think these Archons, it's actually like a little bit low on HP.
Yeah. It's taking a damage on its hull.
All right. Oh, man, that Archon is so close to death. Look at that. Yeah, he didn't lose him. GG.
GVGG.
GVGG.
What's V mean?
I don't know.
Well, Hero wins the group. This is not what I was really expecting, but Hero did say that he was feeling confident this season. He looks good right now. There's no question.
Yeah.
The 31 probe third base kill into defending a giant attack from Sue, and then this nicely executed push.
This
Even game one, he was playing well. He made one wrong move with his main army.
Dude, we've had so many upsets this season. I hope Sue can still move on, but it's not going to be easy. Now we're going to have an interview with Hero and see how he's feeling as Andy will translate it for us. I imagine he's probably pretty happy.
Yeah, he's probably feeling all right.
Do the do.
Mountain
Dew.
Hello, guys. We're going to have an interview with today's first winner. It is Hero. Congratulations. Thank you. The 2019 is the year for you, Hero, as you have made several great performances this season.
그냥 누가 봐도 죽음의 조잖아요.
You know, this group is the group of this.
어떻게 보면 쉽게 올라갈 수 있어서
And you know, just easily getting out of here. And I'm just really satisfied with my performance today.
충분히 그러셔도 되는 것 같아요.
I guess you can be.
승자전에서 정말 강력한 타이밍 공격들을 보여주고
And you have shown very good timings with your attacks today.
저그전 타이밍 공격들이 정말 매서운데요.
And they were really sharp.
잘하세요.
And how are you so good at PVZ?
일단 오늘 너무 아다리가 잘 맞았던 것 같아요.
Well, today I was quite lucky.
나오겠군, 처음부터
And the timings were really really good.
잘 통한 것 같아요. 원래 윤수한테 타이밍이 잘 안 먹혀.
Usually my timings don't go well against Sue.
네, 마지막 세트 공격도 무서웠고 리퍼그넌식 30초 때 공격도
New Repugnancy.
지켰는데도
You went for an immortal push at the 4 minute 30 mark.
운영으로 넘어가는 모습이 정말 연습을 많이
And it felt like you really practiced a lot today.
그 리퍼그넌식 타이밍도 그렇게 딱 손에만 주는 데에서 손에만 주어도 충분히 좋은 그런
You know the New Repugnancy attack was really really good and then really caught the opponent off guard.
제가 그 전에 했던 빌드들이 있어요.
Before that, I used several builds.
근데 그 빌드를 의식할 거라 생각해서.
And I knew that the enemy would know the build. So I went for new creative build.
정말 저그 자원 원탑이 김준호 선수인 것 같다.
You know, people have been saying that you might be the best in PVV matchup.
오늘 그런 왜 그런 이야기를 하셨는지 좀 이해가 됐습니다.
And today I understand why.
뒤에서 정말 많이 갈고 닦고 계시나 봐요.
사실
honestly,
이벨트밖에 안 하거든요.
You know, I just keep going for this build as this build was made by me.
저그가 알아도 저는 타이밍을 만들어.
Even if the Zerg knows I'm coming for him, I still have several other things that I could use.
자, 오늘 김준호 선수의 첫 경기는 시즌 3 첫 투프전이었습니다.
This was your first PVP this season.
내용도 굉장히 좋았죠. 킹스 코브에서는 똑같은 빌드로 분리하기 시작했는데
In King's Cove, you started off a little bit weak with the same build, but then you definitely made a comeback in the end.
뽑는 거였는데 그거 사실 처음 보는 거였어요. 어떤 빌드가요?
You know, the disruptor build, it was my first time seeing it. What was the reason behind it?
그냥 100%로 진단 마인드로 게임하거든요. 그래가지고 이번에는
Well, this time,
이겨야 되지 않나 싶어서
I knew that I had to win.
30일 전부터 그냥 빌드 생각만
And I've just been figuring out the build for like the past 30 days. And I think the build really caters the current meta.
공허의 유산 상대 전적 7-7로 동률이었는데 오늘 경기 전까지 왜 100% 진다는 마음으로 오셨어요?
그냥 느낌이
Well,
이겼을 때도 실력으로 이긴 느낌 아니어서
Today like sometimes you know I feel like I don't win because of my skills.
오늘만큼은 좀
But today, 잘 I definitely think I won because 네. I did good.
오늘은 정말 완벽한 풋프전을 보여주셨는데요.
Today was a perfect PVP.
현재 김준호 선수의 WCS KR 랭킹 7위입니다.
You're currently ranked 7th in the WCS ranking.
블리즈컨 안정권에 진입하기 때문에
And in order to qualify for the BlizzCon, you have to get into round of 4 or round of 8.
네. GSL 하기 앞서 GSL이 미웠거든요.
Well, ahead of GSL,
굉장히 중요한 마지막
you know,
시즌인데
I was really worried, and GSL is a very important tournament for me.
오히려 죽음의 조를 뚫고 올라가.
But now, you know, moving into the next phase, next stage after getting out of Group of Death,
네,
I'm really relieved.
올해 마지막까지 팬들께서는 기대를 하셔도 좋을 것 같은데요.
I guess the fans can be relieved as well.
김준호 선수의 한마디 들어보도록
and last
하겠습니다.
Of all, do you have anything to say?
네, 응원해주신 팬분들 정말
Once
감사하고.
Again, thank you for
이번 시즌
cheering for me.
느낌이 달달하기 때문에
and I have good feeling for this season.
하겠습니다.
And I'll try my best.
네, Please root for me. 축하드립니다.
Once again, congratulations 감사합니다. On your advancement. Thank you.
네, 이렇게 1위 진출자
All right, cool.
What a nice
surprise. Hero actually moves on first.
Yeah, he's looking really good right now. I'm excited to see if he can keep up this form and maybe make it to BlizzCon.
This is exciting. Again, everybody in 2019 is really getting redefined here. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought, to be honest with you, as we started this season, season one of GSL Kodos, I thought it was going to be Maru again over and over and over. It's going to be like Brady Bunch, like Marsha, Maru, Maru, Maru. Not the case. And here's Hero, also proving himself again. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, series number 4. Don't go away.
대회 시작하겠습니다. 진짜 홍해 우산 최초의 우승자가 나왔습니다. 그 이름은 다크 박영호.
2019 Mountain Dew GSL Season 3 Codex.
Listen to that sound. Reversal. It's like Darth Vader's having a panic attack.
Wow.
Okay. Dream versus Zest is coming up next. Let's get rid of one of these players.
Yeah. I think you have to favor Zest here. A pretty good Home Story Cup run. As always, still a very strong Protoss, no matter what Tasteless may try to sell you.
I'm standing my ground on this one, Artie.
Yeah?
Where's
Artie
your ground?
McTosal. Where's your ground?
Where my feet is, where I'm standing at.
Yeah?
I'm actually not standing, I'm sitting.
You think you're standing on an island, you're actually just standing on plastic bottles floating in the ocean, Tasteless. You're gonna fall into the ocean, get
Tasteless,
eaten by a shark.
Your ground is trash! It's total garbage! Cyber Forest. Actually, I think Zest should probably take this one.
Yeah. Well. We'll see what Dream's TPP is looking like.
Yeah, let's take a look. It's good to have Dream back. He's done with his military service. He had some wonky, anachronistic builds early on, but it's a different series. Let's see what he's got. Game one, Zest vs. Dream is loaded up. Let's go. Sing it with me, Artosis.
Dude, Protoss players. No branch, so OP.
Almost to 3960.
3960.
That's how you say it.
Zest. Brave Stars Gaming. Dream.
You know what really struck me about Zest's interview? They're like, is there like a player you'd like to switch places with or whatever? He said Bisou. He's just like so handsome and so good.
Yeah.
I wonder if you asked Bisou that, you'd be like, well, Zest, he's just so handsome and so good.
Can we just trade bodies?
Yeah.
Now, by the way, I just want someone to point. Sometimes I see these pros.
Whoa!
What's going on over there?
We pause the game and I go up with handcuffs and take him out.
That's unacceptable at pro levels.
Listen, you. Who'd you knock out? Who's not in this tournament because you're here, Mr. SCVs, all the SCVs in one patch? What year is this?
You just spamming boxes over that?
Calm down, bro, Seth. God.
That is a sign that he might be a little bit nervous. That's you don't normally ever see that.
Who's clicking like that?
I need more APM. I'm just upping my APM, so I'm ready for later on.
Actually, that's totally fine to do.
No, that's totally what you should do, but if you're clicking all your SCVs,
you're just
find a different spam to use.
Yeah.
God. Pure disgust. Okay, you know what's kind of funny? I feel like GSL is such a long-term pleasure for me in a lot of ways. Like, I was very excited about this year in general with all these players coming back.
Yeah.
But the more I watch them, the less excited I get about them this year, the more excited I get about next year with them.
Yeah, I like this point,
Where it's
some
like,
of them are a little bit rusty, and it seems a little bit off.
Let's see how well MC does. Oh my god, DRG is back. Wow! Bomber and Tasia, wow! Like, all and then like everyone kind of gets wrecked, as they should, because they just came back.
It's like, they're
new. So it's more like,
They're fresh.
Yeah, but you give them another year, and then suddenly it's like, now that's the storyline. Like, next year, who's going to win, the old guys or the new guys? Because we know the year after that, when all the new guys go to the army, the old guys will be winning no matter what. But, let's see how they do next year, right?
And eventually they will all serve their military service and all be done.
Yeah.
And they'll battle for eternity.
Can't wait.
Yes.
So Zest has proxied to Stargate just north of where the natural expansion is, as he's continuing to slow drip a shaded adepts in.
Yeah. There's a Marauder. I wasn't looking at the game yet, so this is kind of interesting. Now, first off, the Oracle coming out seems like it could be a little bit scary.
By the way, this is a concussive shell rush.
Yeah. And I'm not sure exactly what build this is. We'll see if he goes like concussive shells and stim and shields. Oh my God, why is my brain failing so hard today? Anyways, let's see if he goes for all of those right in a row. There was a really cool build. I believe it was Cure that did it recently that looked kind of like that.
Oop, he's going to get the probe. Oh, no, he won't.
Oh, yes, he will. Oh, my God.
That's how I like to play-by-play, ladies and gentlemen.
See that shade turnaround? Come on now.
Ooh! Oh-ho!
It's like in a bounce house.
Yeah.
You ever kill anyone in a bounce house, Stasis?
All the time, Artosis. You don't even know.
Yeah.
Imagine an epic fight in a ball pit.
Well, it's a...
Just getting murdered in a ball pit.
My God. Yeah.
As you're slowly dying, the balls just come over your face. The last thing you see.
I was going to say, a bounce house is a great place to kill somebody because, like, you have to take your shoes off before you go in so there's no footprints.
That's a good point. Yeah.
Yeah. Perfect crime. Can't be caught.
Okay, Stim's on the way here. We did have a different build coming out here, though, from Dream, which is kind of cool. He is definitely... Seems like he didn't just watch what the other Terran players were doing and try to take the more modern approach. He's kind of come in here with his own angle, which I really like. Even if it doesn't work out, it's cool to see that people are approaching the game from different perspectives.
Yeah. And, you know, with the way that he's playing this, he's going to have a lot of Marauders when he moves out. I will bet you he gets that third base.
I will bet you
that, Tasteless. Yeah, seriously, because it's a Stargate opener, right, with Oracle, which is totally fine to go into Blink Stalker and a third base from. That's like, it's kind of an older build itself, but it's good.
Yeah.
But the fact that he has two Marauders being produced at once, he's going to have Stim, and he already has concussive shells.
Yeah.
These Blink Stalkers, like, well, here's the caveat, right? If he tries to go through that little hole right there, that everyone... I think that most people don't realize that there are other paths on this map.
We do
because
have a lot
everyone
of
just tries to go through the center. I see so many people lose the game because they just like they sit at the center for days trying to go down a hill and up a hill through the thinnest point in the map.
Okay, here we go now. One adept shading over there. Oh my God! Now he's gonna get the that's the armor upgrade.
Yeah. It so really does not matter anywhere near as much.
Yeah. Getting rid of the stim would be huge. We've seen this thematically. In GSLs before, where players come in and literally try to just destroy the stim upgrade, which then keeps Terran sort of in timeout back at home because they can't really pick any fights on the map.
Yeah, it's a great move. Good tagging going on, so he sees where this is all coming from. But yeah, the actual standing army right now of Dream is really scary. Some good micro from Zest. Pulls back for now. Doesn't have charge yet. It's really important because that's one reasonable counter against this many Marauders. Dream right now starting to bring out more and more of his army. As you push those Stalkers back, you have more potential to push. Doesn't have to hit right this second. He has plus one and combat shields coming.
Okay.
Zest, man. He just wants to fight.
Yeah. No, he's doing a great job. But I think Dream's handling this very nicely.
Yeah, he is. You're right about it.
And from here, there's a lot of momentum right now for Dream. He's going to try to come out on the map and try to pick a fight. Now, the Stalkers, especially at a distance like this, they're great at kiting. You know, you can hit, you can then try to blink away, and you're trying to chisel this army down. I mean, there's not a ton of medevacs here. Now there's a ton. Yeah. There's four, so never mind that.
Like, if you just had your Stalkers at your base, then... I mean, he would already be there, right? Now, what has Zest done? He's whittled down the army and bought so much time for more warping rounds and upgrades to finish and gateways to finish.
Yeah.
So it's just, it's such a key part of this game.
Okay, two Immortals over here. I don't know if he can get any more progress here trying to leapfrog forward. Nicely done.
Yeah, good Forest Fields right there. Really well done.
Okay, all the Zealots destroyed there by the Widow Mines.
But look, this army that Dream has, he has a lot of potential here because he does have those mines, right?
Yeah, so, he does.
That plus the Marauders are just kind of good against Stalkers.
slowly, I think they're starting to edge in here, though. It looks like every mine does get picked off. This will force Dream to retreat, but again, Stalkers are not just great at blinking away. They can actually help in pursuing over here.
Yeah, gonna back up for now. Both of them holding their side of that tiny, tiny little choke. Looks like Tech continuing forward here for Zest. Gonna get some splash damage mixed in there. I actually wonder, because he has so many Blink Stalkers, do you think he's going to go Colossus or Disruptor here? Because normally it's just straight up Colossus, but against this many Marauders and everything, and he has so many Stalkers already, I wouldn't mind a Disruptor.
Yeah, I don't think either one is necessarily wrong, but yeah, I think it would be very cool to see him try to use Disruptors here. Now we've got that Oracle being chased away. It's finally destroyed there by the Viking. And let's see if Dream tries to actually attack in a little bit here and tries to actually do any more damage, because I think that was pretty effectively held off there by Zest.
Yeah, it was. He actually held it all a lot better than I thought he was
going to. Oh, it's
going to
be Thermal Lance and Colossus. Okay. Mm. But this is Zest. I guess we kind of have to expect him to do that, right?
Yeah.
I don't feel
you
like
don't
Zest
see him
is going to just scramble into Disruptor
much.
Play. Yeah.
Like, if there was a Protoss that was going to use Disruptors, it would have been Hero.
Right.
For sure.
Don't forget, guys, Sue is waiting to face the winner of this. Player here that loses is out of GSL Season 3.
Yeah, the last Codex of the year.
Yeah.
It's early to go. Okay, so the army of Zest is starting to look very, very nice. Getting a Dark Shrine here as well. That's kind of interesting. It's pretty early, actually, for a Dark Shrine.
Right. Yeah, that is actually a little bit peculiar. Not a bad idea, though, just not standard.
Normally you'll get it, like, maybe even after you started Tempest, but definitely after your second splash source. But this is, like, after his first splash source. So that's it's a little bit of an investment when you're not on that many bases. Interested to see what he does with that.
Well, Zest continues to roam here. I don't know if he can quite attack in yet. But he might just try it because Thermal Lance is close to finishing.
Yeah,
you want to get the. Sorry, go ahead.
With his fourth base coming up, I like that he's just kind of clearing out some of these areas so his army can move around a little bit more fluidly. I don't think that an attack here is necessarily what he should be doing. Like, maybe he does. He's break down the rocks and you can attack down the hill, but I think with the Liberator setting up, you can't really break anything right now.
Oh, that was weird. I don't know why those Marauders just ran up there.
Not sure either.
Okay, he backs up. Yeah, I don't think he's going to be able to break into there. But if you notice, what is occurring here is that a fourth base is pretty much impossible to get. There's Zealots over there on the far right. Oh, my God. And because he actually baited the army away, he was able to come in there and pick off both of the Liberators, which now is giving him an opening. Now he can set up over here. And this is also going to cut off the Terran from trying to expand towards the bottom. Another warping comes. You know, frankly, look, I think the infantry is going to get pulled away again. Oh, my God, no, he's just going to go for it.
Yeah, a lot of the Zealots are actually missing over on the other side. Some good EMPs go down, but in this kind of choked up area, it's pretty hard for him to get through and get that damage done. The Colossus is doing so much damage right now. It's ridiculous.
Oh, my God, that's it. He's going to get sandwiched.
Yeah, it seems that way. But a lot of those expensive units on the left actually ending up going down. SCVs finally come out to fight, but is it too little too late?
I think there should be another warp in coming here in just a little bit as well. There's going to be a pickup and nice sniping there on the medevac. The CC is going to go down as well.
Ooh.
And
brutal.
Terran scans and sees, wow, there's a fourth base already being taken. Now, Dream did manage to sneak that command center over to the center right. We didn't get a shot of that yet. My concern, though, is the next few warping rounds are going to allow Terran to just march over there and then take that out, too.
I tell you, I'm impressed with the attacks that Zest has pulled off, especially after those nice early game defenses. His PVT looking really, really nice. I feel like Dream could have held that a little bit better. He was kind of back. I mean, Zest utilized the terrain beautifully, the positioning of the command center. It made it so thin, that area, for Dream to try to get out there and do anything.
Okay. I feel like there's not that much that Zest has to do to basically keep Dream under control, right? I mean, this is a real uphill fight for Dream.
Yeah.
But basically, he's so limited on everything he has, and you know, Artosis, you were talking about this earlier, but players trying to push through there. Oh, nice EMP, though. Takes out all the energy on all three of those sentries, so no more force fields for now.
Definitely a decent EMP. I guess he will be able to go through that center area now.
Yeah, sees the Colossus, time to lift off those Vikings.
I don't think he can break this, though. I think this is just like, hey, we may as well attack.
Yeah, I think he just wants to see if he can maybe push back through. He did kill off a decent amount of the army. Even only Marauders, his Colossi are just getting such good shots off on the clumped units.
Yeah.
And the two Immortals, not even being microed really on the low ground here, but eventually this just dries up. GG! Zest takes game one versus Dream.
I liked Dream's overall ideas and approach in a lot of ways there, but again, it felt a little bit like game one of Dream versus Sue, where it felt like Zest outplayed Dream overall.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
He whittled down the army a lot, he slowed him down a lot, his attacks were very good. And even though there were times where it felt like Dream had enough army to do things, he wasn't in the right positions to do those things.
Also, when you look at a really good player against a player who was maybe on top of his game but is trying to come back, you can see that Zest is making a series of very good decisions that put him in just a better spot later on in the game. Like, by the time we were getting to the point where Zest had seized total control, he had that Zealot army at the top, he was pushing in and breaking through. Yeah. To get the third base. I mean, it was a pretty technical takedown, and after Dream had finally fended it off, but he'd lost the third base, it's easy for Zest to close that out. I don't blame Dream for counterattacking, but it did not work. Mm-hmm. He'll have to try something different here in King's Cup. One thing I wonder as well, is he going to have some new weird builds? He keeps bringing out his own style. It's just not working yet. All right, let's start this game. Game two goes on now.
Ooh, are we Max Paxson? What is this?
Proby Mick Probe Dobe. Look at him going out across the map. Yeah, let's see if it's going to be that.
It's two probes, though. Gate in the main. What?
Nope. Good block, good block. The barracks does get set up. What's his plan here? He hides a second.
Okay,
the second probe hides the pylon. The first probe darts into the main.
It seems like it's just going to be two gate play, which is, I mean, this is a pretty standard build. We see this a fair amount. With the speed with which he sent out the first probe, it felt like it could have been a Max Pax, but
he's doing a little bit of, I guess you'd call it harass. He's interrupting the mining patterns of the workers. Mm-hmm. Not a huge deal, but you know, with some of these very, very specific rushes, anything you can do to slow them down is going to help.
Yeah, I don't mind that. Once you pick up the minerals like that, though, I feel like you really want to be harassing SCVs as much as you can.
Yeah, any little bit of extra damage you can do, because there's such a limited number of units early on that any little chipped damage that you have on an SCV or, you know,
if you can get any unit to die in one less shot because you harass with your probe, that's actually real value.
Now, you can see Terran is intending to make the CC down here. Mm-hmm. The probe did a little bit of delaying. And just an earshot away is that gateway that's about to finish.
Yeah, and with how quick the probe came, it's very unlikely that you're going to scout for a proxy.
Right.
Because no one sends out two probes like that. That's why we were kind of caught off guard.
And also, you know, it would look like, in fact, the Protoss was trying to confirm that there was no cheese coming, when in fact it is the Protoss who's doing the cheesing.
Yeah, yeah. It was, this really masked everything very well. And because the Reaper did not check for it, this command center is going to have to be canceled as soon as he sees the Stalker.
And this was going to punt the Terran into an awful position, because his entire idea in this build is themed around getting that base set up and then trying to get into a healthy late game where you have a series of decisions you can make. And so he sniped that down. He's actually going to get a few more kills off on that. Immediately cancels the command center.
Wow.
And let's see how well Dream can intuit what to do next. Again, the bunker is not finished.
This is actually terrible.
Oh, my God.
He's getting the add-on, so maybe he's going for a Cyclone, maybe he's going for a tank. But the amount of damage that this has dealt already, and Zest can easily expand behind this.
Yeah.
It's not
an
issue.
This is...
Okay, he even cancels that. Oh, my God.
This is a perfect just setup. To win this game. Is the Reaper dead? I don't think we got a shot of it, but I'm assuming it's gone.
Oh,
yeah, the Reaper's dead. Oh, boy.
It
the depot might be going down. Oh, no. Okay, so that means that now Terran's supply blocked. There's Stalkers in the base. We're waiting for the Cyclone, but I don't know that it's going to be enough. Fortunately, these are not.
Oh, that was actually a pretty good two catch. Of the Stalkers.
Suddenly, they turn into StarCraft 1 SCVs and just drill through and get him. So he actually kills off both those Stalkers.
And look at that. He's going to get another one. Okay, so, I mean, he ends up defending this and doesn't die to the initial push. But without any doubt, dropping to 14 workers.
Yeah, this is terrible. I mean, with the Protoss at 24, that's huge. Mm-hmm.
Zest from here. I feel like he can do just about anything. I imagine he's going to be going into Blink with this Twilight. And that harassment itself is going to be very hard to stop.
You know, the problem is that the Protoss, even though, you know, there was a little bit of an error in how the control was going down there, this is still a serious Protoss army that's coming at him.
Yeah.
You could attack, expand, and tech.
Yeah, that's
in
true.
In this moment as Protoss,
with that
okay?
much damage, absolutely. It's not like there's any awesome attack that Dream can be gearing up for right
you
now.
Its
production is so low.
You could be a fish, a bird, and a land mammal all at the same time. You're underwater and you're on the land.
The duck-billed
platypus.
Yes,
you can be a platypus in this game. This is just, look at this, he's gonna get the Cyclone. Oh, he body blocks it with the Adept.
Yeah. Just the constant soccer pressure. His Nexus finishes up. He's already mining from it with some probes.
We have another Cyclone coming here. Again, it's a tech lab out of there, so he can only make one at a time, but I think this is where, yeah, he's just gonna run up here and just run him over. GG.
All right.
Zest.
One side of that one. Dream said himself he's not quite ready yet, still practicing very hard. So, again, I think he's one of these players that next year has a real shot at surprising us. I think next year is going to be really hard to predict.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to this. And, you know, Zest showing a little bit of a smile there, but he has to go up against Sue. Yikes.
Well, that's a great battle. It's
it
a little
is.
Bit of a rivalry. These guys have hit each other so many times.
They're that's both, right.
Two of our best players from their respective races. I think this is going to be a great match coming up.
I'm looking forward to it. We're going to go to a short break, and we come back. The final match of the night here in Group D. It'll be Zest versus Sue to decide which player goes on to the round of 16. We'll be right back.
Steps and I have no regrets, no mistakes. Shine my black shoes, cause I wanna move. What do you choose? There are too many options. Do not take me down with the fears you've raised, because they are not mine. Running so fast like a shooting star, till I hit a home run. Aim so wild, I cannot be tamed. And with every step I take, don't you ever look through my side. Aim so wild, I cannot be tamed. And with every step I take, don't you ever look through my side. Go for the spotlight like a Trojan horse, ready for the fight. And I do it with small steps, and I have no regrets, no mistakes. Wear my best suit, cause I cannot lose. Pumping up my mood, there are too many options, and they can take me down. Everything is now in place, because I hold the edge. Yeah.
역사에 한 패를 장식한
어떤 카드를 던질까에 대해서 머릿속으로 진짜 고민이 많아질 수밖에 없는
상황입니다.
연전 연승 달리고 있는 맨체에서는 지지 않는 포스터를 뽐내고 있는데
어! 이경기도!
진짜 이걸 잡아요! 이경기도! 진짜!
에브리바디 째째!
이미 서론 드리스트를 입히게 했어.
바라봐야 될 태양! 걔 어떻게든 살아나라! 포기하지 말자!
2019 Mountain Dew GSL Season 3 Code S Reversal. Nothing's gonna
save you from the fall. What's up, everybody? We're back at the GSL, and it's time for the final best of three, Zest versus Sue.
Yeah, I mean, this is an amazing match to be seen here in the round of 32. It's called the Group of Death. You see a match like this as the final match, kind of feels that way, doesn't it?
Yeah, this is gonna be a great match. I will say I think Sue is the real favorite here, though.
Okay. But didn't you say that about him versus Hero?
Yeah.
Okay. Just checking. Keeping track, keeping tally. When you're right, when you're wrong. I'm like Santa Claus for StarCraft predictions for Tasteless right now.
Let's just say I've been naughty.
All right, New Repugnancy, King's Cove Turbo Cruise. Okay.
So this is it. One of these guys gets eliminated, man.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Same vetoes going up as that last PBZ. All right. Let's do it, Tasteless.
Yeah, Zest dunked on Dream, but this is a whole nother level taking on two. Let's see how this goes. Game one is up.
Point.
Ocean Gaming, Zest. Chivo, Sue.
Okay, so this is the last one for tonight. This
yep.
Was, 48. Okay, so the round of 16 has 20 matches. We have 20 more left in the round of 32, so that's 40. Yeah. Plus 4 from the round of 8, 44. 2 from the round of 4, 46.
Look at this guy 47,
go. 47, right? So 48 plus 47.
Mr. Math on TV, look at you go.
We're at 95. After the season, we're going to be at 95. Do Super Tournament matches count?
I want to say they should.
So if Super Tournament matches count, we will hit, you know, that next 100.
And then what happens? Is the confetti that we've installed in all of, you know, the building, is it going to come down? And
when will we?
Do we get to kiss the trophy? How does that work?
I guess we'll hit that milestone, I guess, whatever, the 3,600 matches or whatever.
Yeah.
On day two of Super Tournament.
Nice.
First match.
I'm ready.
If Super Tournament matches count. I think they do. But I'm not sure.
I'm actually not sure, to be honest.
Otherwise, we have to wait until next year.
Bring it on. I'm ready.
Bring it on.
Bring it on. By the way, it's good to be back. I want to thank again everybody who covered for me while I was on my family vacation. Artosis and I are in an open relationship as far as casters go. He can cast with other people as long as I'm allowed to watch.
You are allowed to
watch. Yeah, that's right. As long as I'm allowed to watch, it doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, but you can't type in the Twitch chat while you watch.
No, I can't. No. I certainly would not do that. I made the announcement on my Twitter, but nerds were still bugging me about it.
Yeah.
Tasteless, where are you? It must. You must be gone because somehow you're a bad person.
If only, like, if only being a bad person was the way to get Tasteless off.
It's good to be back, though. It was weird having the tournament go on and me being on a trip, but it's good to be back. Yeah. So we had the Twilight Council come down, and there's a robo coming behind this.
Yeah, it should be just a pretty standard stuff here. The DT-based Archon drops a lot of times can lend themselves to very strong mid-game timings.
Yeah.
Sometimes we see 2-base, sometimes we see 3-base with that. 2-base has been a bit more popular with it lately.
I gotta say, this is very Zest-like to do.
Yeah, he's a guy that really likes Archon charge builds.
Yeah.
He really does. He was pretty addicted to them for a while.
We've got quite a bit of Zerglings up here at the entrance.
Yeah, I like this a lot.
And it looks like they're going to try to drive through by killing the Stalker off.
Well, they're definitely going to get the Stalker, which is super nice.
And from there, they're now going for the Cybernetic Spore.
Yeah, why not?
And yeah, with the Adept out, there's no reason to pursue that further. But this is a very quick layer build here with the Roach Warren as well.
Yeah, he's only on 2-base.
Yeah, he's...
Sometimes with these 2-base builds, we've been seeing a lot of 2-base Swarmhost Nidus. I don't think that's what we're going to see this time.
You think he might just have a Nidus pop up somewhere and the attack just start right away?
I don't think so. Like, well, I mean, it is... A Nidus wouldn't be surprising itself, I guess. I think he's just going to get Roach Speed here. I don't think it's going to be Swarmhost or anything like that.
Okay.
Be a little bit surprised if it is.
And now there's one War Prism coming out, so we're very close to actually having the Archon Harass come in.
Yeah. Well, actually, because he made the Immortal, there's this other build floating around right now where you fake an Immortal push and you make DTs. And that can be really, really tricky.
Yeah.
Right? But there's actually two Overseers that were made.
It's on 2 bases, too, so this is, like, so easy to defend.
He's buttoned up tight. But this is it's kind of like a fake build that we're seeing here. See, the DT is going to be sent out. Maybe he can do something like snipe that third hatch. Yeah, it's so low on health, he should be able to force a cancel on it. So that's pretty nice. This will bring his attention elsewhere.
Okay, so the hatchery is undefended. The Adepts will come in, try to one-shot as many drones as possible.
Not as nearly as big a deal as it would have been otherwise. Like if that was an actual functioning base. Charge and Immortal on the way.
So not really that much impact-wise. Oh, dude, if he get the Archon.
That is so nice. I guess he won't quite get the Archon, though.
Not bad, though. I mean, you can't do any harass with that for a little bit.
Yeah, that's annoying.
That really mutes the effectiveness of this entire strategy, if you can actually just take all the shields off of that.
Yeah.
And so from here, he continues to expand out and get more and more control over here. But it looks like we're going to have a follow-up timing attack. There's 5 gateways coming down now.
Yeah.
And he's already made those Immortals. I mean, the cool thing about this build is you get the fake off right away, so you have the opportunity to just kind of blindside them with Dark Templars.
Yeah.
But then you were making Immortals behind it, too. Mm-hmm. So then you have a pretty good Immortal count. You throw the gates in a little bit later. Obviously, you're going to have more Archons and Immortals than you would just tier 1 units, but it can set up pretty nicely.
You're kind of trading... In a game like this, you're trading, I feel like, some sentry energy for some serious potential for early damage. All right, some decent harassment going down, actually. Getting a decent amount of drones there. A very interesting build from Sue, by the way. He's already got +1, and he's going for +2. This third base, obviously, very, very late. And he has a Hydralisk den, but we don't see Hydras quite yet. Obviously, if you can get into a decent amount of Hydras, you can start to hold some of these pushes pretty well. But I'm a bit afraid for him when the actual push comes out. Like, is he going to have enough to stop that with just Roach?
Well, let's find out. Again, more and more Ravagers being made. Now, a lot of times in this build, we see the this basically get ended when the Warp Prism is sniped off.
Yeah.
And so the really good players are quite conservative with where the Warp Prism is. And it's really a balancing act of having the Warp Prism safe so you have warp ends, but keeping the Warp Prism in close enough proximity that you can still juggle the Immortals.
Yeah, are you going to be able to hold this? Look at how scary this is right now. Oh, great force fields right there.
Oh, man, that's perfect.
Amazing force fields all around.
Well, he is pretty much out of force shields, though. Again, yeah. That's part of what you're giving away with this build.
Hard to block off. Okay, that, I can't believe this is just out here in the open, but I guess he calculated that there were not quite enough cooldown vials there.
Yeah.
And so...
keeps it alive.
Yeah. I mean, it's still coming through here. Four immortals are still doing well. He needs to get that one immortal though on the right. And that was pretty late. I mean, you want to really not let it take much more than shield damage there. And it just seems like Sue just ate through this, takes the warp prism out.
Wow.
Oh my god, not even a recall there.
What a solid hold from Sue there. I was a little bit nervous at the beginning of it, but
Sue bashed that sword. Oh my god, look at that. Had the hatchery maybe been killed off, we could, you know, speculate more, but the hatchery's alive, and I don't see. And
yeah,
with no warp prism, he can't even pick up an immortal and try to fly over there and hit it.
I know, and that would be easy. Just two shots? No problem. Might throw a transfusion down on that if he gets the energy for it. Would not blame him. Oh, I guess he already did, actually, didn't he? It's already up to 232.
So the warp prism's being remade. We have two shield batteries over here at the third base because there's probably a little bit of insecurity here from Zest. A big counterattack could smother that base and kill it off.
Yeah, very cool, by the way. He canceled the Hydralis upgrade and the plus two during that.
Oh, I didn't even notice that. Good call.
Yeah, so he's restarted that now. Very good play there by Sue. Holds on, and now that he gets into Hydra, this is very different from the game against Hero. Remember, obviously it's a different build from the Protoss that he's against. But against Hero, he just kind of was like, okay, let's go kill you. I have so many Ravagers. Let's do
right.
this. And Hero's build was a bit more on than Zest, to be fair. But now that he's getting into Hydras, it gives him a lot more potential to do different
yeah.
things in the game. His army is actually going to be something that scales a little bit better, more damage output.
Well, let's see if he can try to do some more damage over here. It looks like the Warp Prism is not going to be there to reinforce. Instead, he's going to try to mass warp in, sort of discombobulate Sue on his defense, try to get him defending, over-defending one location. I love this one DT.
Yes.
There is an Overseer hero here, excuse me, but there is a chance that might not go that well noticed. Looks like it's continuing to kill workers. As long as he shift-clicks down those drones, that's quite a bit of damage that it did, and it lives through that attack. Nicely done.
Yeah, if you're not losing anything, getting five drones, that's really sweet. He's trying to draw attention over to this third base area as well. That's kind of a dangerous area for Zerg, but never really decided to commit right there, so he's going to pull back to his own third base.
He does have enough force fields he can probably block off pursuing armies.
Well,
I guess not, actually. The Lings are going to get a surround on that Immortal. Too bad he did not kill that. He actually miscontrolled that a little bit, ran off for a second. This arc is so bad for Protoss.
Yeah, he has got to get up there. He does have some shield batteries back here, so shouldn't be too much of an issue. Ooh, going to drop a couple DTs in here and maybe snipe that Queen down.
The thing is I think there's just enough here. This doesn't really do anything, right?
Seems so.
And now he's going to rotate over to the natural. And by the way, Zest was not fast enough to really block this off. And so this attack is going to go down.
Yeah, some great vials coming down and just eliminating those force fields right away. Zest actually have enough here. These Hydras adding so much damage, and I feel like he's just going to be broken.
Well, there's just no Warp Prism here. I mean, there's no way to juggle these Immortals.
Yeah.
And juggling Immortals is the greatest thing that you can do in StarCraft II. There's
the
nothing more
thing.
Powerful in any computer game in the world than juggling immortals.
Yeah, I guess
okay?
you're right. Yeah.
And so this just, he can eventually muscle his way in here, and that's it. GG. Sue takes game one.
Wow. Okay. Very well played by Sue there. Very different build order going for that two base layer, getting the speed and plus one very, very quickly. Zest going to have to go back to the drawing board. Your pregnancy really was kind of the rush map that we have out of the three maps. We're going to go into King's Cove next, and that is more of a macro map like we were talking about. Even Hero, going to that much later game against Sue there.
I'm ready. Let's do this. Again, I think Zest strategy was actually one of the cooler strats we saw come out here. It's just that Sue, is fine against whatever is coming his way,
Mm-hmm.
So... it's hard for me to imagine Zest winning here. I'd be excited, but, man, Sue looks very, very strong.
Yeah, he is looking really good, and he should be if he's saying he's going to win this season. So, see if he can take down Zest here. But Zest going out in the round of 32, this has been a little bit too common for my taste in the past years.
Feels bad, man.
Yeah. Isn't this guy supposed to be a world champion by now?
Thought so.
I feel like he was... the promised one or something, right? He had two GSL titles, and how many Protosses have that? Not a hell of a lot.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. All right, game two is ready. Let's do this.
Ocean Gaming, Zest.
Watch this. Computer, identify that base over there.
Chiba, Sue.
Oh my God. How haven't you come up with that yet?
I don't know. It's that sound effect. It sounds like some kind of futuristic device. Now, let's see what Zest tries to do this time around. Because he did have a very cool strategy. Like, intellectually, it was really interesting to see. It just didn't work at all. I mean, Sue completely slapped it down. Sue also had an unusual tech that he went for, which kind of zoned out the opportunities that could have come from what Zest was trying to do.
Yeah, if it was something else that Zest was doing, maybe Sue would have had a harder time there without having that third hatch with any type of speed. By the day, it works out. Yeah, now that we're on King's Cove, definitely plays a lot different from New Repugnancy.
Okay, here comes that third base. Not much we can remark on right now. Kind of wait and see what plans these guys got. Do you think there's any sort of mainline build that Zest should be trying to do here? Because I feel like there's certain things Zest just won't do, right? He tends to avoid the super crazy kind of SOS play or high-risk, high-reward hero-style play. He seems to want to kind of pull out the old textbook of Captain Careful builds here.
Well, I think he should play similar to how we saw Hero play.
Okay.
I guess he's absolutely not going to. Twilight coming up right away. Mm. Now, I mean, this could be a few different things. I think it's probably a DT opener again, though, if I had to guess.
Do you think it could be the same DT opener we had? Sometimes when you do a build that really can only work once, even in a best of seven, pulling it out twice, even if it didn't work the first time, it might work the second time because your opponent is also assuming, okay, you played that hand, you can't do that again because it wouldn't make any sense.
Yeah, I mean, maybe. And let's not forget, like, Sue did a very odd build that last time where he had two Overseers before the DCs even got there. This is a much more normal opener from Sue. So maybe he has that extra potential to make it work. Well, let's see. Come on, it's done. Oh, he's waiting for the gas. Yeah, it's going to be Dark Shrine.
Cool. All right, let's do it again. I will tell you, though, if you lose doing this build two times in a row...
Well, he can still just do straight up the DT Archon drop, right?
That's true. Actually, no.
It doesn't
you're
have to be the Immortal. Let's see if he makes the Immortal, because that's where you start faking it. And Sue caught on pretty quickly to what was going on.
Three gates going down. Let's see. Where are the Overlords placed here? Just one?
Yeah,
outside the natural.
It really looks to me like it's just going to be the Archon drop, which I think is totally fine.
Yeah, and in this case, he can then revert back into just a very standard style, try to come out. Now, do you think you just go make Archons, or do you want to try to spring the DTs on him?
Yeah, you bring the DTs first. Like, when this build was the most common build, a lot of times you just go straight Archon because everyone was ready. But right now, you know, there is always the question. So I think definitely you give the DTs their little go and then just morph them. You're never going to get that much damage done, really, with the Archon drops anymore anyways.
Scouting Ling spots the Warp Prism. So this is going to give Sue a few moments to prepare.
Yeah, Depp's going to clean that up a little bit. Distract him, perhaps. Spore on the way. Roach is coming out as well.
We do have a Spore at the natural as well, so the DTs should not do anything, assuming that the other player's ready.
Well, let's see.
Let's find out.
I mean, four DTs can actually fight something.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's a lot of damage output when they're all together.
Seems like he's actually... Oh, look at that sweet move.
Yeah, that was great.
In the main base?
But there's also a Spore up here.
Yeah.
Now, can he try to dive onto the Spore, perhaps? No,
he
wants to just try to fight. The Adepts are over here.
Ooh.
Okay, he's going to go try to power down the Spore. Good transfuses. But the damage is coming out too fast.
Oh, he finally does get it right there. There is an Overseer on the way, but it's not there yet. 11 drones killed off.
Yeah.
These Adepts doing some work in the natural.
If the drones have to be pulled away, it's a long... Oh, my God, it's so low. 4
hit points left.
That's so crazy. Had he lost the War Prison with the four DTs, that would have been a catastrophe.
If there was an Overlord there, it would have killed it.
Yeah.
Just brushing against it would have done four damage. My God. Clutch recall right there.
But that was good. That went really well.
Okay. Third base, Forge on the way. Zest setting up for a longer game, I think, as he should. Is that the same prism? With just four health? I know it is.
I think we have to whisper in a moment like this.
If we're too loud, it might die.
Yeah. Even sounds can damage it.
Look at that.
Oh, it is.
Oh, my God. An EMP would that prism, kill it.
I bet it has an eye patch on it. Okay, he's going to have to go around the edge here. It is such a brittle unit right now. It's so low in HP, the Queen's gonna easily target it down if he's not careful.
Yeah, he's being very careful right now. Okay, so the game should normalize a bit from here, I would say, right? You're doing some light harassment, getting your production going, getting your Nexus and probes going.
Yeah, this map lends itself to more conservative play. You kind of get your, I shouldn't say conservative play. It allows you to mass up and macro up. It's a friendly map for a macro player.
Yes, absolutely.
Hydra would like this map. Oh! Nice targeting here. He's got to be careful. This is such ambitious maneuvering here with the War Prism. Mm-hmm. But, you know, had those Archons gotten a little bit further in, they would have shot down so many drones.
Now, the Hydralis Den going to be finishing up here. I wonder if he's waiting for that for his fourth. I feel like the fourth base should be taken. Like, I feel like he should have taken it already, in fact. Like, okay. It shouldn't be done yet, but it should have started, right? Because even if you spend all your money on units and try to go across the map, are you going to be able to break him?
Yeah, well, at this point in time, organically, you just have the extra minerals to make that base. But maybe he's staying back because he wants to try to fish this War Prism in? I don't know. But yeah, we don't see any fourth base yet.
The harassment's still here.
Yeah.
It's just, like, look at this. Zest has more workers than Sue right now. And they have the same amount of bases. That's not good for a Zerg player, right?
The Zerg needs to out-expand the Protoss here, so...
Yeah.
I'm not sure what to make of this.
Well, he just keeps making Roaches and Hydras, so I think what to make of this is that Sue's going to walk across the map, but if Zest stays on top of his ramp, especially if he chronos this Psystorm nonstop, maybe he has an extra shield battery or two, can you imagine him breaking through? Like, it seems unlikely. Or maybe he goes into... Maybe he gets all the upgrades and goes into Lurker and then tries to do it. Because I have seen some strong Lurker pushes against 3-base Protoss here, where you burrow the Lurkers at the bottom of the ramp.
Oh, yeah.
The Protoss
kind
of has to fight there, and then there's a lot of damage coming up the ramp.
Yeah, and it's all in a very controlled, condensed space as well. And so it's like just sort of hard for Protoss to use the assets they have to fight it. Yeah, I think you might... Well, no, hold on. There's Ravagers coming here, too.
He's just moving, so...
All right. This is just like I make a lot of stuff in attack build.
Yeah. Well, I guess he's going to try to hit multiple locations, right?
You can't I feel try like this is hard this to ramp. Do on this map, though, but...
Yeah, I would agree.
If he makes it work...
Force fields are strong. Immortals are strong. Batteries are strong.
Yeah, the ramps kind of
create
such a bottleneck.
Yeah. Look at that tiny little ramp. You going to come up that tiny little ramp? Well, I guess opening it... is a good start, right? Because then maybe you can rotate around and get him out of position. Has a full energy sentry there. Look how many mortals there are.
Okay, here we go.
You coming up this ramp? Sue, you coming up this ramp? Come on.
Are you chicken?
Yeah. Okay, there's the Lurker Den.
Okay.
Which I think that is...
And there's the fourth base, by the way. A very late fourth base, but mm-hmm. All right. We are one of you. Oh, they almost got in. All right, is he just going to push out? I'm sorry. Yeah, I think he can actually just come out here and fight this, right?
Ooh, like, I don't know. I don't think so.
Well, he thinks so.
Well, he's flanking with four High Templars on attack move. That's pretty sick.
Yeah. So what wins, a High Templar or a Roach? I'm just not sure on that Templar attack, Solartosis. He's going to try to come in from behind. Now, this is a lot of Immortals on both sides.
Yeah. Yeah, he's just sandwiching it, I guess so. Look at that. That is a lot of Immortals.
Look at that.
Yeah, and even attack me with
those
High Templars.
Why did Sue try this at all? This is just...
No, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense, the attack from Sue.
I'm very confused about this.
Yeah. I guess the flank actually did work out, even though it was a little bit sloppy there.
Well, I think it's only natural that when the War Prism comes out, Protoss just pushes and kills the fourth base, right?
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, there's just not much else to say.
How can you stop this army?
But this seems to be almost more of a fault of the Zerg. I mean, not to try to take anything away from Zest, but I'm genuinely confused about what ideas Sue was trying to utilize here to win. Just very unusual, especially coming from Sue, who usually seems to always have a very good grasp on how the race is supposed to operate in pretty much any circumstance.
Well, attacking up the ramp against all that certainly did not seem right.
And honestly, it's just not a good strategy on this map.
Yes.
The third bases are very safe on this map.
Yeah. And you don't want to play like a robot on any map, to be fair. And he played a little bit weird on New Repugnancy, which was cool, but it just kind of goes against the theory of the game. It just like should not work. Oh, hold position,
oh
lurkers.
My God.
Oh, sick. Oh, awesome move right there. He actually got a few high templars.
Yeah, he
really pushed everything back.
Both
lots
of the
damage.
Archon stuff.
Yeah. I think you back up here as Zest.
Zest may try to go around.
Yeah, I mean, that
you
is
know,
a lot of immortals, though, isn't it?
With the lurkers present here, though, this angle's kind of tough, right?
Yeah.
A lot of times the zealots sort of lead in. You can't really lead with the zealots because they all just evaporate. So instead, he's going to fracture them off and try to get some control of basically the 12 o'clock area on the map.
He's got a huge force of zealots up there. I'm not sure what the idea is. He's going
to
move all of his army
get
up here.
Get this overlord.
Well, I guess you can't really be flanked here, right?
Right.
So this movement, he comes in from just one side, but that's good lurker positioning, it seems.
Yeah, but see, the lurkers can rotate. They just reposition, create a different concave.
That's very true.
Well, now this small army can come down and actually pick off these Templars, which are... that's such a bad moment there for Zest.
But that flank, pretty good, I'd say.
Yeah. Unfortunately, a lot of these Immortals are not quite able to get their shots off.
Oh, yeah.
A little bit of a quicker army here. Yeah. He sends these Zealots through, but I'm not sure what the story is with these Zealots. Okay, hold on. He did not reposition. And so he can actually break these Lurkers down.
Yeah, now, the rest of his army coming up for the flank.
Sue's actually maxed out, so we should be seeing a lot more coming up over here. There's actually 30 more roaches being made right now.
And he's got a decent amount of Hydras here to really help out.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, man. These Hydras are going to be great against these Immortals, and there's no way you can get all these out of here. So kind of an odd turn of events.
You know what? I think that because of these five observers, he's going to be able to get out of here. That's about the craziest F2 ever
I would have been more happy if I had six observers, but okay. I guess all he needs to do is make sure they're all
See those lurkers.
Okay, now he just narrowly escapes, not going to lose anything. Meanwhile, the War Prism is going to loop back in here and try to draw more attention into Sue's main.
Yeah, he's still producing a lot of Immortals here, adding another Stargate, gaining the Fleet Beacon as well.
I think, actually, there's a chance we have a lurker push coming up here on that fourth.
Yeah, maybe. Oh, well, he's staying on that layer tech for a very long time. We do not see an infestation pit or anything.
Yeah.
You think it's going to be Tempest or it's going to be Carriers? I think in this situation, Carriers are good.
Yeah, I think you might be right.
It's just the fact that he's still on Lair, he doesn't have a Spire.
Yeah.
And he's making Lurkers. Yeah, man, give me some Tempest. I mean, some Carriers. Let's see it. Do it.
Well, he's getting a lot of Zerglings here. Now, keep in mind, a lot of the Archons were wiped out. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of this weird Templar Immortal army. So Lings are going to be pretty strong here.
It sounds like a strong army still, though.
yeah.
Okay, it is actually going to be Tempest, though.
All right, so Tempest are coming.
Yeah, he's really completing his tech here. So it feels like right now what Zest needs to do is sit back ultra defensively. So he's completing his entire tree at this point.
Okay, now this is a very wide area to try to defend. But again, not a lot of anti-Ling units over here.
Yeah, good size storms, though, overall.
Okay, nice footwork here. But Sue is now going to be able to come in. The storms are beginning to dwindle. We have some Archons being made, but the Roaches and the Lurkers coming forward.
Oh, my God. And he's actually pushing everything back. This fourth base is going to be under siege in a moment here, but almost nothing left.
Yeah, there's no War Prism here as well.
Oh, my God.
So there's no way to pick this up.
Look at the DTs go to town. No Overseer. Oh, my God. The flank of Zealots here as well.
Zest, excellent play here. So now you can clean that up. GG, we're tied up 1-1.
Oh, my God.
Hell yes.
Going right to the brink right now. Turbo Cruise 84 going to be our next map. Sue has stated he's going to win a GSL, and here he is, one game from elimination against Zest.
I'll tell you what, though, Sue, that was not the same Sue we've seen in the other games here tonight. I mean, that was a very, very odd attack by him.
Did he feel like he was so far behind he had to do that? I don't think so. He held on fine against, like, the DTs did all right in the main base. But he kind of deflected everything. Zest started expanding. That, those attacks up the ramp, that definitely bottlenecked him into a weird position, right?
Yeah. Okay. Our players just now joining the lobby. This is it. This is the last game of the night. Either Zest or Sue survive to the round of 16. That's how crazy it is, Artosis.
Okay. What a time to be alive.
What a time to be a gamer. All right. Our game's up. Let's do this. Game three. Da-da-da!
Seems like it's just a hatch block.
Okay. What's it gonna be? Gateway.
Yeah.
There it is.
So just blocking the hatch.
Yep, this is fine. This is a great way to just try to get some control in this game over here.
Very, very annoying here for Sue. It's just going to go into its gas and pull, it seems.
Oh, my God. He lost the probe. That is
not
common.
You're not supposed to do that.
You know, sometimes these little errors at the start can kind of telegraph the player's mental state. You know, you're really not supposed to lose that probe.
So yeah.
The whole job of the probe there is to try to get in the way and stop stuff. Now, he lets the pylon finish. You could see there was some internal debate there by Sue about, like, you know.
Well, he thought he was going to cancel.
Yeah. He thought okay. He might come back. And then he said, nope. Yeah. And that was, you know, a little kind of little fancy move there by Zest, good intuition.
Yeah.
To let that finish. You got to try to make it a little bit weird here.
And, you know, because he lost the probe, he actually doesn't know that there's a hatchery. Mm-hmm. For all he knows, a Roachhorn will be on the way something crazy. So you see that Zest is not making a Nexus as of yet. He throws down Cybernex Core first. It's kind of a little bit of extra safety for him here. Seems like he's getting ready, but he's got to get back here and check it out, see what's going on. Looks like he's going to send it directly in the main base, the easiest way to figure out what's up.
Yeah. So we'll come in here and see there's no Roachhorn up. Good link control here. A necessary move to try to confirm what exactly is going on here. And now these links will take out this pylon. But even though Zest didn't execute this perfectly, as far as ideas go, I think he had a very good handling of the situation.
Yeah.
You know.
It's okay. You know, it doesn't seem like he's in a terrible spot or anything like that. He's going to send an Adept across the map. Where speed going to be a little bit quicker than we normally see. So Adept isn't going to be able to stay for too long. Stalker coming up. What tech does Zesso go for here? GSL life on the line.
That's the big question here, man. I don't know. Coming here, going for Larva. Not getting much from this. That's one thing is if you force the hatch to be further out, sometimes there's just nothing there. Mm-hmm. Unlike the natural.
Ooh,
oh, good kill.
Yeah. Very swift, keeping it right on top of the drone so it couldn't become a spore.
Still waiting for a queen to hatch out here to help defend. There's the robo coming down.
Yeah, he's making a sentry as well. So let's see if he grabs these additional gases. I think he will.
Yeah. There's a chance it could be some kind of push coming out.
Yeah, it definitely could be. Normally when you see the robo, it is going to be something aggressive. It doesn't 100% have to be. There are some more macro-esque openers. And you can fake it as well, which
sure.
Can be a powerful, powerful move. You know, when everyone was going to Mortal All-Ins, I like some of these moves where it's like you get the Forge and you go for +2 and +3 bases and then do your Immortal attack.
And the Zerg's way overreacted.
Yeah.
It doesn't have the right assets to fight
it. 44 drones and, you know, 100 roaches. Prism coming out.
Okay, so he'll have some opportunity to get some real activity here on the map with that Warp Prism coming. Back at home, Sue's droning up, trying to stabilize here on three bases and get an economy going. We do want to watch and see how much defense is going to be available here, because it looks like right away we're going to have the two Adepts come across the map as he wants to try to come in here and one-shot as many workers as he possibly can. Now, there's Immortals being made back at home, so there could be a setup for another attack later on, but either way, it's always... Whoa, very cool. Totally different.
So I was just
double Stargate.
I was just about to say, a lot of these builds have looked very similar, right? Prism flies out, couple Adepts, right? It's like, oh, are DTs on the way? Are, you know, is an Immortal push on the way? You know, obviously, Glaives has to be something in the back of your mind. But to go into the double Stargate, right, he's kind of forcing Roaches out because it does look like one of these builds again. And double Stargate is such a fantastic counter to Roaches.
Oh, yeah.
It's ridiculous. And there's nothing to scout anywhere nearby that I can see, right?
Yeah, I mean, Roaches don't do anything in a situation like this where they're going to be
He's faking this push so well.
Yeah.
Right? He's walked out. He's cleared Lings several times. A lot of Roaches being made.
And you can pull up quite a lot of Phoenixes before you actually have to show them what's going
Absolutely.
On.
Absolutely.
And you can see already armies are being split up and sent around. And it's fairly easy for Zest to try to do this, to try to roam the map and generate the appearance of a real threat coming his way.
Now, a lot of Lings being made as opposed to Roaches, so that's a little bit better against the Phoenixes for sure. I think the... maybe best case scenario here for Sue is that he can deny the third base for a little bit. But he's not going to know about the actual tech route until the Phoenixes decide to show themselves.
Okay, he started Immortal production again. He was trying to come out there. It was a little bit earlier on, but trying to feign pressure there.
A lot more Roaches now, being made.
Yeah, I think that we've actually seen Sue get duped here. I'm very curious to see Sue's face when these Phoenixes fly out.
Yeah, that's going to be a moment.
Sue realizes this is not the game he thought he was playing.
I think he's going to show him at 6. Is he going to wait for 8?
No,
he's a madman. He's waiting for 8 Tasteless.
That is crazy. I thought he would for sure go out at 6, actually.
He's waiting for 14 Phoenixes.
Yeah.
Sue's going to have Corruptors by then, not knowing what the hell's going on. Okay, here we go.
4 more gates coming.
Oh,
is he not sent him
out yet? He's waiting for 10!
He really is going to go for that 14, Artie.
Oh, my God. It's like the longest I've ever seen Phoenixes kept back.
Do you think there's a chance that Sue... Well, I guess
Sue has
He does it because he's still making Roaches, so the answer is no.
This
is a very suspect thing for Protoss to just be on two bases like this. I guess he thinks it might just be some kind of really late Immortal.
I think he's thinking
attack.
It's like... Maybe Glaives or Charge is finishing, and plus one is finishing. But yeah, this is ridiculously strong. 10 Phoenixes coming across the map.
All right, here we go. Okay, so immediately he sees what kind of game this actually is going to be. Queen's being picked up right away. We have the army actually moving out now for Sue, headed towards the base, hoping that perhaps there's not enough at home to defend.
This is the only thing he can do is counterattack.
Yeah, yeah.
And the counterattack will be scary. Do you use all your lifts right now? He's dealt so much damage already.
Dude, he's going to kill every Overlord. This is insane.
Yeah, he might want to actually bring his Phoenixes back. I'm not sure. Like, is he going to be able to hold this easily? Maybe he will.
We'll see.
That's a lot of Roaches, though.
Almost supply blocked him here, so what you see
is
what
you get. There's a Prism, he's going to hold this. He's going to hold it just fine.
Okay, the gateways are going to be torn down, and then it's going to be up to Force Fields to try to... sandbag the progress of this push.
Yeah, he does a recall here on the Phoenixes just to make sure. Yeah, look at that, picking up the very valuable Ravagers
here. And now he can't deny Force Fields, even though there's not that many available left anymore. And look at this, he can kill this off, and then he can immediately go back and continue to do damage.
Oh, yeah.
Sue is getting totally crushed here.
He really is.
So he's just now made enough Overlords for Phoenixes to come back in and kill them again and get supply block.
Yeah. Watch this. This is just
not all the time
we
get to
situation.
See this, but there it is. Nope. Occasionally, if you have enough Phoenixes, you kill this many Overlords, the Zerg is locked out of production. And then he's just making Phoenixes, which will ultimately just be killed off. And he's going to kill every worker.
The supply block would be real, but he's killing all the workers, right?
Yeah.
He's kind of helping him out like that. Just setting him back completely.
Okay. Again, anything that he sees over here, he just picks up.
He supply blocks him. He's like, are you supply blocked? Let me help you with that.
Let me kill some drones.
Let me kill 30 supply of stuff with these units that you haven't seen.
I'm surprised he's not attacking in further. I guess he just knows he has to play it safe from here.
Well, he's so far ahead right now that flying around and killing roaches even is fine.
Like, yeah.
He just continues to gain massive value from these phoenixes.
And now he can even come in here and nab up some queens. I mean, even with spores here and queens, the damage is so tremendous.
Yeah.
That everything's just getting totally killed here.
Wonder what Sue's plan is here.
Where's the lion's share of the overlords? There it is. It's down here.
Yeah.
Oh, I was wondering. Okay. This is like such a painful way to lose a game.
Yeah, Sue continues to grimace. Every time the phoenixes find a new area that he's not defending well enough. 22 overlords.
22, it's the same number as drones that have been killed.
Wow. And twice as many as roaches.
Oh my god. It's just this cluster of overlords here. And hydras and queens are just scrambling to try to defend it. Meanwhile, infrastructurally, Zest has, like, everything he needs.
Look at that.
Oh. His immortals have spoilers on the back of them.
We need a skin like that where everything has a spoiler
on
it.
Yeah, yeah.
I would totally equip a Zealot skin with spoilers.
Yeah, just a little spoiler above his butt.
Yeah. It's like Snape kills Dumbledore.
So, I guess the question that everybody, including Sue, is probably asking himself is, what do I do now if I'm going to recover? And I don't know what that answer is. I mean, the abuse that could be unleashed when these phoenixes just pop in at various angles. Look at this. These units, not trading anything, by the way. It's not like it's a big ground fight where stuff is dying on both sides. I mean, there's a phoenix here or there that's picked off, but these phoenixes have paid for themselves like times 10. I mean, the sheer amount of damage that's been dealt here is insane. Now, it does appear that Sue's out, that he's going to try to go for. I don't know if he believes in it or not, but he's going to go for it, is to go for Hydra Bane.
Yeah. Can't really blame him for that, right? The Hydras, once you get up to a certain number, are going to do reasonably well. Picking up Ling Bane Hydra is not all that easy.
Right.
You know, he's playing against massive amounts of mortals. It all kind of makes sense. But you see that? You see those, like, blue squiggly lines on the production tab?
Yes.
It's in between plus two and charge.
Uh-huh. What's that?
That's the counter to everything that Sue has left.
Oh, you mean the lightning beams, huh?
Yeah. I think it's called Lightning Storm.
Yeah.
And Lightning Storm is going to be amazing. Okay, he's getting a Fleet Beacon. Why is he getting a Fleet Beacon?
Just because, man. He wants to have it all, you know?
I actually feel like if he makes any units off the Fleet Beacon, I guess Mothership is fine. Yeah, Mothership would be a totally good unit here. Anything else, though, I'm like, oh, actually, you're trying to give Sue a chance here? Like, Carriers and Tempests are about the worst thing you can make in the whole world against Ling Bane Hydra. You just do not want that stuff. But yeah, Mothership would be really nice.
This Tempest, is so impressive. You know that Alan's Karaoke is down there, too. There's all sorts of stuff on the sides of these buildings you never notice.
Well, maybe that's where Sue will go after this.
Again, continuing to fly in and do so much damage. We have Tempest now coming out. I think this is a smart move to just recall these back
home. Yeah, you may as well.
Creep spread, by the way, a little bit lackluster here.
How is he supposed to be spreading creep against this?
I had not taken any notice until this moment. I thought, oh, yeah, he has like two little creep roads.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, my God.
Makes me think of July Zerg's games way long ago in StarCraft 2.
He had like three tumors total.
Yeah, stretching out to his opponent's base.
That's always what I think of with bad creep spread.
Yeah.
It was, like, literally the worst ever. Except for the very beginning where a lot of Zergs just didn't spread it.
Yeah.
I don't like my units being fast. I'm like, yeah, you're a great RTS player. That's why you're still around. Oh, wait, you're not, and I don't remember your name. Okay, so that's a lot of Psystorm. That's a lot of Immortals. Sue is on 49 drones against 54 probes.
Yes. So again, another one of those impressive games where it's like kind of crazy that Sue's even keeping up in supplies here.
Yeah. Yeah, they're both max, I guess.
That's definitely true.
That's one of the, you know, that's one of the nice things about having supply caps in StarCraft.
Yeah.
Is that if you, it's kind of like a way that you can equalize some games where you give yourself a fighting chance, right?
Can you imagine how bad this game would be if there was no supply cap? People just kept making stuff and turtling.
That would be so
the PC
weird.
Starting to slow down. We're like, all right, well, this is usually where the game crashes.
That would be...
There's too many things to...
To be fair, though, let's see if you agree with me. I think that would be a better feature in StarCraft 2 than StarCraft 1, because StarCraft 2 is harder counters.
Mm.
StarCraft 1, that would get out of control so quick.
No, you'd be incentivized just like, to stay there forever.
I have 112 siege tanks. Okay? Leave.
So what is the deal here for Protoss? Is he just going to try to expand up here and then try to push down? Because I don't see any movement.
He's just mass turtling and getting into even higher and higher tech. But I feel like that is not what he should be. This is my opinion, okay? And Zest, obviously, much, much better than me. But I feel like this is the way that you give Sue a slightly better chance.
I really expected some kind of a timing attack to come out here, and it just never did. And
well, I think just maxing on a ground army with Psy Storms and Immortals and stuff and some Archons to just kill this, and then like maybe even trading your Phoenixes somewhere, I feel like that would have been, you know, a really reasonable way to go about it. But going into like all these flying units against this very tempo-ish composition.
So now he's pushing up over
like
here.
It as much.
Meanwhile, the Phoenixes are once again killing every Overlord in the game. Phoenixes are actually flying into other StarCraft 2 games on Battle.net and killing Overlords there, too.
Phoenix is dying. There are Overlords everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah. It's just insane.
They're going to go extinct. Going to get all your supply through hatcheries from now on.
Okay, oh here comes that push we were waiting to have happen. Now, keep in mind, most of the Banelings were spent. There's about 25 more being made and a few additional ones roaming with the army, but I think there's so many storms he can easily mow this down as well.
The storms are really the huge, huge problem here.
Not to mention this green stuff that slows everything down. Makes this counterattack where he's trying to go around not very good.
Watch
just
this
storm
flying.
That.
Hold on, guys. We'll be there soon.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Psy storm under the green area.
Yikes.
Yeah. It's just...
All right.
Too much from Zest here. The Phoenixes did way too much. But look, he actually, like, clears the ground army. How funny is that? GG.
GG. Zest manages to defeat Sue. I'm very surprised. I'm very impressed.
Yeah. I mean, some good play today from Zest and Hero. And I think overall, Sue played... he played well today, I would say. You know, we had a couple mistakes. Couple interesting decisions attacking up ramps and stuff, but that's really unfortunate to see Sue go out so early, right? He had a round of 8 last season. He's always a player that's exciting to watch go far.
Guess we'll have to wait for next time.
Yeah.
In just a second here, we're going to go to an interview with Zest and see how he's feeling now that he is the second player to advance out of Group D into the round of 16.
Hello, guys. We have our final winner in Group D, round of 32. It is Zest. Congratulations. Thank you. It is your first round of 16 this year. How do you feel?
일단
well, first of all,
너무 그 올해 30위간 계속 탈락해가지고
it's been such a long time making it to the round 16, and you know, adapting to the environment was pretty hard, and I made a lot of silly mistakes.
네, 안 그래도 그 올해 주성 선수의 GSL 성적이 정말 this year,
your performance this year has been quite unfortunate.
본인이 가장
And I'm pretty sure you are very disappointed as well. That's right. Okay.
네, 좀 아쉬웠고.
Yeah, it was very disappointing.
제가 어떻게 보면 나이가 이제 많이 차가지고 올해가 거의
I'm kind of old now, getting old. And I try to
아직 기회를 살려서
try to play it to the best I can.
네. 그러고 보니 오늘 주성 선수 생일이시라면서요.
Today is your birthday, actually.
아, 오늘이 아니라 내일.
Oh, it's actually tomorrow.
내일이세요?
Okay.
그래서 정말 많은 분 팬분들이
you know, a lot of the fans here are here today to celebrate your birthday, and they brought lots of presents as well.
응원 또 큰 힘이 됐을 것 같거든요.
And I guess the fans' cheer was quite instrumental to your performance.
생일이 전인데 그 경기
well,
떨어지고
it's my birthday eve.
우울할 것 같아가지고.
But I thought if I was eliminated today, I would feel depressed.
자신도 있긴 있었는데.
But today I was kind of confident.
긴장을 좀 많이 해가지고.
And but you know, at the same time, I was too nervous and ended up making some silly mistakes, and I gotta really fix that on.
더 큰 힘을 발휘하시지 않으셨을까 하는 생각도 듭니다. 자 오늘 최종전에서 저그전
today,
승리를 거뒀습니다.
In your win, today in the final match, you gained the victory over Sue.
이미 승률이 올라가 있는 상황이었기 때문에 이 점은 참 긍정적인 의미가 있는 것 같습니다. 저그전 좀 잘 되세요.
How's your PVZ matchup?
네, 테란전, 토스전보다 저그전.
Well, recently my PVZ has been better than PVT and PVP.
네, 근데 저그라는 종족이 원래 좀
Zerg.
스토리와 맞다 보면 금방 적응을 하거든요.
As a race, you know, you kind of get used to the strategy.
해야 된다는 게 좀 스트레스인 거.
And Zerg has like this limited build.
그래도 지금은 좀 네, 괜찮은 거.
But now I think it's quite fine.
오늘 최종전에서 빠르게 판단을 내리시는 모습도 빛이 났습니다. 마지막 터보 크루즈 다수의 불사조는 바퀴 중심
터보 크루즈 맵 in the last match.
아주 좋은 카운터가
you showed stellar performance with the Phoenix.
그런 영향이었습니까?
일단 윤수 스타일이
well, first of all,
약간 이제
Su's play style
자기가 병력을 많이 찍어 놓고 상대가
is like gathering up lots of army
아니면 그걸로 영러시 가서 자기가 약간 끝낸다는 마인드가 강해
and like he goes for the all in with his big army. So if I keep pressuring him consistently that kind of renders him to be on the backside.
윤수 선수를 잘 알고 계시는
you definitely know Su very well.
주요했던 것 같네요.
And I guess that's a
자, 이렇게 저그전은 상대에 대한 이해가
very
좋았다면
nice point from you today.
이 푸프전 원조 기계격인데 좀 아쉬움이 남습니다. 오늘
I guess your PVP was quite disappointing today as you lost against Hero.
빌드 준비만 하셨다고 하더라고요. 주성 선수는 어떤
I heard that Hero was preparing for his build 30 days ago. Since 30 days ago.
이기고 나서
After Hero won,
칭찬하는 발언을 했었는데,
he was kind of complimenting me.
But 항상 뭔가 저를 이기고 약간
Stats and Hero, every time they beat me, 네, they kind of just chuck this compliment, and it doesn't feel that good.
네, 조롱이라고 생각을 하셨던 것 같습니다.
And you say that 자, if you feel mocked by his compliment.
어떤 모습 보여주실지 사실 상당히 기대가 됩니다.
Well, we definitely look forward to how you'll play this season.
블리즈컨을 놓고 본다면.
And since this season is very important in terms of BlizzCon, do you have anything else to say?
지금 그 홈 스토리 가서부터 엄청
Ever since I'm going to the home story club, I've tried really hard, and if I just keep up this pace, I think I might be able to make the impossible possible.
네, 다시 한번 2위 16강
Once again,
축하드립니다.
Congratulations on your advancement. Thank you.
네 이렇게 디조의 2위 진출자 주성 선수 만나봤는데요.
Cool.
디조 경기 최종 결과를 보겠습니다.
Again, I'm a little bit stunned. Sue didn't make it, but tell you what, I'll always take upset results.
Yeah, it was a very tough group though.
Yeah.
We certainly have three players here that deserve to be in that round of 16, but it's not how it works.
Yeah. So, there you have it. Hero looking very strong. Actually, really pulled through here with some brilliant play. I'm hoping to see. The hero that we saw in 2016, here in 2019. And of course, I'm always happy to have Zest advance. Dream did a great job in his games, but ultimately was unable to hold his own against these other players. And that's okay. I think he's gonna have another year or two before he can really find his footing here.
Yeah, I think next year he's gonna be in really, really great shape. It takes a very long time to get back into form. Well, the thing is, it's not even back into form. I guarantee you he's better than he's ever been. Everyone's gotten better though, so he has to raise up to that now.
So tomorrow, guys, at 8 p.m., we normally start at 6:30 p.m., so it's an hour and a half later than when we normally have the show. So for those of you guys that usually miss the first part of GSL, you're in luck. We will be starting a little bit later, and it's going to be a long night for us. So definitely come. Well, actually, I was going to say I'm going to come down. Hopefully you can get the train ride home back because the train's closed. You know, they're not open all night.
Yeah.
But, well, yeah.
No, that group will be really fun as well. Like just seeing Maru and TY both in it. Of course, Super coming back to the least acclaim out of everyone, I think.
Yeah.
No one's really talking about his comeback, but here he is in Code S, so that's cool. And then a very high-ranked Zerg amongst the Koreans Impact. Very aggressive Zerg. We'll see if he can maybe make some upsets, but the Terran players definitely favored tomorrow night.
Right. So that it does it. It's good to be back here casting with you guys. I did miss you guys. And before we forget, hang on to your tickets if you're in the studio. We do have giveaways. We've got a fan. No, we don't have a fan for a giveaway. I tried to memorize it. A scarf.
Just make
and what was the other one? Photo book, but no fan. Okay? No. We don't just give fans away at every show.
And you can make anything into a fan, though.
If you want to get a fan, come to ASL, okay?
See, my hand's a fan now.
Yeah.
Get the photo book, just like that.
There you go. Fan. That's true. Photo book can be used for many things. Yeah.
I think, yeah, it's been a good night. It's been a fun night. Some interesting games. Sad to see Sue go, but some Protoss is getting through.
Yes.
And I think tomorrow night will be a Terran night. When's the next time we're going to see a Zerg get through? I don't know.
Might be a little bit. I think you're right
Maybe
on
Saturday.
Tomorrow night being a Terran night.
Yeah,
it's going to be interesting to see how TY does. He's been casting for us now that JYP is in the military.
Yeah.
And that's a tough balancing act, being a caster and a player in major tournaments. So we might have a little bit of a surprise, too. And then we go, well, maybe we shouldn't be surprised. He's been casting the whole time. He doesn't have time to practice.
But maybe casters are really the best players. I don't know.
Maybe they are, yeah. Maybe players are the best casters. Maybe that's how it is. So that's going to be fun to do. And, again, 8 p.m. tomorrow. We never have shows at this time. So definitely if you're a regular – We never have shows on Thursday either. That's why it has to be at 8 p.m. They're using the studio for other stuff. But our schedule is crunched here at Afrika TV, so we got to get all these games out.
That's right. Another day on Saturday as well. So,
yeah.
Definitely going to be very busy. Don't forget to watch the Pylon show tomorrow morning.
That's right. And the Tasteless Podcast has a new episode out with Wardy. Thanks for joining us, guys. We love you. Have a good morning, afternoon, or night, wherever you are. Bye-bye.
Let's make it count.
I must fight his souls.
Next.
GSL Season 3. Reversal.